people a few years ago were talking about how Harriet Tubman was forcing people at gunpoint. I think that story was made up anyway. That's just my opinion.
Why do you think that?
She's going to force, okay, I'm just even looking at the practicality of it.
Okay.
It's too easy for somebody who didn't want to go to just go run up to the house and tell the master, Harriet's down there with a gun. And we wouldn't even be having this conversation.
Wow.
I mean, it's very simple. I mean, you know, she's got to go to sleep and whatnot. I mean, you know, she's running an underground railroad. I mean, hey, that whole thing would have been blown out of the water real early. Her whole operation. If she was forcing black people to leave at gunpoint. I think the white supremacists planted that seed out there just a few years ago.
Hmm.
Oh, yeah, that's how she got them to go, you know. Harriet rounded them up and marched them down the road to the river with a six shooter, you know.
Wow.
I mean, it doesn't add up. With the conditions being what it was and everything at stake, slaves were expensive. I mean, you better believe master put out $2,000, I mean, in currency on some slave. And he didn't want to go. And Harriet's down there with a gun. I mean, sneaking around in the middle of the night saying, you know, I know where your cabin is, you know. And if you're not out there, come here. When I come down there with the rest of them, with the other four or five that I rounded up today, if you're not out there, I'm coming looking for you, and I'm going to shoot you if you don't go. That doesn't even make sense. Nothing about that sounds, rings any kind of bell. It makes any sense at all.
Hmm. What about the way I hear it, or the way I've heard that mythology, is that the gun would only come out once they got off the plantation. Like, all right, once we leave, there's no turning back, because you'll get us caught, you'll get us in trouble. And then the threat of the gun once they've already, you know, got...
Harriet has to go to sleep. You know, she has to eat. I mean, she got 1,001 things to think about, including staying alive. Dogs chasing them and all like that. I mean, they had to run, they had to cross rivers. I mean, those people that got away with Harriet, I mean, got away because they wanted to go. And man, I mean, it was scary too all the way. She couldn't force nobody to go nowhere. Oh, you know, even if they heard a rumor that she was rounding up people at gunpoint. Is Harriet at gunpoint? I mean, you know, she's the only one got a gun. Because if the rest of them had a gun, I mean, hey, they'd have a whole lot going for them. I mean, black people didn't have guns. They didn't have access to them. A lot of them who had seen guns, they'd seen plenty of guns, I mean, in the hands of soldiers and all like that, but they didn't know about even handling no gun. And the kind of guns they had back in those days, my goodness.
Hmm.
Half of those cap and ball rifles wouldn't shoot half the time. I mean, no way in the world somebody wanted to get away from Harriet, they couldn't get away. And not only that, you talking about snitching. And Harriet, you talking about shooting me? You know.
The Cows, Context of White Supremacy. Gus T Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Wednesday, December 4, 2019. So I have been told. We will be here tomorrow. Reading is more important than watching television. We are discussing a book today, our book club tomorrow. We are all done. Paul Robeson's, or rather it is Dr. Gerald Horn's biography of Paul Robeson, The Artist as Revolutionary. All done. Tomorrow, moving on, new book, haven't even decided what that will be yet, but finishing off Paul Robeson tomorrow, normal time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. The audio segment that we began with today. Neely Fuller Jr. is a hoot. Man, producejustice.com. You can visit his website if you want to check out any of his counter-racist literature. But him sharing a word or three about Harriet Tubman some years back, we'll see if it's logical. It is important. One of the things Mr. Fuller says, question everything. System of white supremacy, racism, primary weapon is deception. So a lot of times it can be difficult to ascertain truth, especially if we're talking about historical records. A lot of times racists, number one, are in charge. They are the authority author of records. So they get to write things from their perspective, and just can be difficult to ascertain truth about what happened yesterday, what happened 200 years ago. He was talking about some of that with Harriet Tubman. And I think we shall see, make sure I'm not making things up, but I think that in part motivated our guest for today's broadcast. We normally don't do fiction. We are doing a biography. We have done a boatload of biographies on our book club through the years, but we generally don't do a lot of fiction on the program, and particularly historical fiction. I think that's maybe never in terms of historical fiction, in terms of books that we've read on the broadcast, even though my personal top 10 does have quite a bit of fiction. I think I've said, without guilt, Ralph Ellison, Invisible Man is number one. And the late, great Toni Morrison, Bluest Eye, also in my top five. So fiction is there. 2000 Seasons. Fiction is represented, but that is generally not what we read or study on the broadcast. But our guest thought that a fictional account would be a great vehicle because of some of the problems I just mentioned. Not everything gets recorded and you don't have information. Sometimes there's disputes about what happened. So sometimes you kind of have to go by the record and use logic, try to fill in things as best you can about what happened. The fictional account, say that many times for emphasis, just because this is kind of a rarity on the cows, us discussing a novel. Our fictional account today is of Harriet Tubman, titled Tubman Command. This novel is not really examining Harriet Tubman's time on the Underground Railroad and trying to liberate slaves that way. This novel is examining her time as a scout leader, in fact, with the Union Army, and what she was doing there, really the same efforts to liberate black people, same motivating force there, and examining this period of her life, which the author contends is not very well known by many folks. We'll even, I think, make time to see how this all connects to the biopic, which has gotten a lot of attention. I don't do slave biopics or slave films either, so I have not seen that, but I am very aware of how much attention it's garnering and getting people talking, so we'll see if there's a connection as well. In addition to writing the book that we're going to be talking about today, our guest is the Melbourne Glasscock Chair in American History at Texas A&M University. We've had a few guests from that institution. Dr. Tommy Curry is one that comes to mind, but a few. She's also a senior fellow at Stanford's Hoover Institution. I think we've had a few from there, too. She is a New York Times best-selling author, and I will see if I can steal maybe 3 minutes to see if we can get her to give us a word on her PBS documentary film, Cyberwork and the American Dream, because that is also a topic that we have been discussing. I know Thomas in New York, if he's not seen the film, would be very interested in Cyberwork and the American Dream. But here to discuss the Tubman Command, so thankful she could share some of her time with us, Dr. Elizabeth Cobbs. Dr. Cobbs, you with us?
Yes, I'm right here.
awesome. Thank you so much for sharing a tad of your Wednesday evening, or I guess afternoon. You're in California, West Coast time.
It's getting dark, though, so we're just about in the evening.
Absolutely. For listeners, I'm sure a lot of folks, this is their first time, or some of them at least, this is their first time hearing about you and your work. Anything you think would be important for folks to know about who you are, what you do, briefly before we get going?
Well, maybe just to say that I've authored 8 books of American history. So I've written on a lot of different topics, and, my specialty has always been actually U.S. foreign relations, but I write a lot about war. And I realized as we were looking at 2015 and, the announcement that came across during the Obama administration that Harriet Tubman was going to go on the $20 bill, that even I, who had written so much on American history, knew about as much as I could fit onto a cocktail napkin about Harriet Tubman. I really felt like we all needed to know more about her, and so that's why I decided to devote my 8th book to her.
That is something I agree with wholeheartedly. I think all of us could stand to learn a lot more about Harriet Tubman. What a life. What a counter-racist life. Also, for folks who have not seeing you, you are a white woman. Is that correct?
That's right.
Groovy. This program, The Cows, I use the term racism and the term white supremacy. I use them as synonyms, and I use the same definition for both terms. The definition I use is as follows. A global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
Good questions. I don't think I would agree with that altogether, in the sense that I don't think that there is an overt conspiracy to do what you're suggesting, this sort of worldwide subjugation. I do think that's happened. And so I think that it really, it's incumbent on all of us who are white to be a part of, reversing that. The term you use, counter-racism, is interesting to me. I usually, when I speak with my students, I teach in Texas, I talk about anti-racism, but whatever you call it, counter-racism, anti-racism, I think, anybody who has a shred of integrity, needs to be a part of that.
Okay. So you said you did not agree. You said it has happened. If what I describe, system of racism, white supremacy, if that has happened, at what point did that stop?
Oh, I don't think it stopped. I mean, I think that, I don't want to argue my smaller points of it, but I think that that we live in a world which where white people are at the top, do dominate, and that's true. I don't know if you could say worldwide, but close to it. Certainly true in this country. So I think, and in the same way that men dominate. That those are just irrefutable facts, whether or not, I guess the part of it, that I was listening to your statement was kind of like, is this the conspiracy? Is this the desire of everybody who is white to do that? I don't hold with that. I don't think that's true. But I do think that that is the system.
Awesome. And one of the points, I said it already today. Deception, that's one of the main ways racism, white supremacy operates. I have concluded that often whites, either deliberately, unconsciously, whatever, the end product is they have a difficult time being honest when talking about racism with non-white people. So as much as possible, if we could be as honest as possible and no pussyfooting, that's another thing I've observed with white people and them not being direct. Oh, we got to laugh already. That is another thing I pay attention to, white people laughing in conversations on racism, particularly at this juncture. Because this is important. This is one of the ways that I feel white people practice racism deliberately often. When you ask a question, they don't answer it honestly, or they will pussyfoot and talk for 5 minutes and they still haven't answered your question. Maybe it sounds like they did, but they really didn't. That's something I would really appreciate that, even if you don't agree. No problem. Ooh, we'll move on to the next point. Let's see. You talked about Harriet Tubman in her efforts as a scout, that sometimes mm-hmm. she would raise the point that it would be important for she or another black face to be present because the black slaves that they were trying to, or the contraband, I'll say, that they were trying to liberate, they might not trust a white person. And that
Absolutely.
Is logic. Hey, same logic. So the question, do you think it's logical that 2019, that any non-white person in the known universe be suspicious of any white person, including you? Do you think that's logical, 2019, almost 2020?
Well, I think it is. I think that we've never really had, to me, a full enough conversation about racism in America. That I think that it's very, very natural for any person of color to look at someone with my face and not know, you know, is this what kind of reaction they're going to get. And so, you know, I guess people would be more or less suspicious depending on their own, you know, personal background and, you know, sorrows that they've experienced or not. But, you know, I think that it's a natural enough question. I agree with you on that.
Much obliged. Last question before we start getting to Tubman Command. There is a quote. It's a non-white author. He wrote this around 2015, I might add. And he said, this was published in a major publication. He said that white people are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism, but rarely are they pained enough. And I've looked at the first part of that sentence, and I have enjoyed asking our white guests the first part of that sentence. White people are often greatly and sincerely pained by racism. As a white woman who studies U.S. foreign relations and your historical work, slavery in the U.S., even current studies, do you think, white people that you've been around, the work that you studied, do you think that a significant number of individuals classified as white are often greatly and sincerely pained by racism?
You know, I don't think the word often belongs in that sentence. You know, and by the way, my laughing, this is me. I am a relaxed and cheerful person. I mean, I have a blood type, which is B positive, and I just, that's who I'm going to be on this radio show with you. But I don't think that I really especially agree with the second half of the sentence, which is that it's not often enough. I think there are people, yes, who are genuinely and sincerely, you know, pained. Is it often? No, I think that it's more rare than often. Because unless those non-white folks are parts of our families, you know, they're our children or our brothers-in-laws or whatever, that people don't feel it. And that really was one of the reasons why, for me, to write a book like The Tubman Command. I think that fiction, you spoke a lot about why, you know, fiction, and I think fiction builds empathy. And so that goes back to your sentence. So in that sense, I agree with parts of it and disagree with others.
Empathy. I don't remember using the word empathy.
Well, feel the pain, right?
Okay. Often, the word often should not be there. I've said for a long years now that is not an accurate statement. That's what I said. People are frequently not accurate when we talk about racism, white supremacy. That is a big reason that we have trouble solving this problem. I guess as we pivot mm-hmm. to Tubman Command, the audio segment that started off, that was Mr. Fuller. Do you have any thoughts on what he had to say about this? Because I hear that a lot, that Harriet Tubman, you've got her holding a rifle on the front of your cover, that she had her gun. This is when she was on the Underground Railroad, that she was forcing them at gunpoint, and it's no turning back, and we got to go. What do you make of his thoughts that I don't even know if that's true? That doesn't even seem logical.
You know, I think that parts of it are nonsense. I was listening very carefully to that. I don't think she forced a single person to leave slavery. There's no indication that anybody who went with her, you know, wasn't, you know, didn't want to go. Probably the closest to that you might come with was her parents. You know, her parents were, you know, not older people, you know, they weren't really, I mean, she had to go back and say, I'm getting you out. And that's often we deal with our parents trying to transport them in dangerous situations. Well, hers far more dangerous than any of ours today, but, you know, older people don't want to leave what they're familiar with. But no, absolutely not. Yeah, but could she carry a gun? Yes. We have her testimony that she did and that she used it so that if somebody started to bog down and, you know, turning back, you know, she'd say, I've got this gun and, you know, we're going to go forward. So I don't think that, I think, don't you, Gus, I think of that as being very, very different from forcing somebody, you know, to flee slavery. I don't think that that was ever the case. It was just more like, you know, when somebody gets really scared, what do you do? I mean, she had all of these lives depending on her, not just the person who was getting cold feet, literally probably standing in a swamp, but also the other people who were trying to go forward whose lives were endangered by someone else, you know, giving out or giving up.
Didn't mean to interrupt. That absolutely could be, and this is why I said at the beginning, not all things, hey, that can happen with history. You end up having different perspectives about what you think happened, and not everything can be verified. I will say, you talk about Harriet Tubman's disability as a result of racist violence that she experienced, where she would go unconscious from time to time. If I really was having second thoughts about all this and cold feet, as you say, if she has spells where she's going to go unconscious, oh man, gun or no, as soon as she goes out the next time, we are out of here. If I get five steps, I'm gone. This is, you know, 19th century. It's not like she's got an endless supply of ammunition or the best rifle or whatever you think the best rifle would be in the 19th century. Factor that in as well in terms of accuracy, how reliable this weapon is going to be. Just something to think about as we proceed. Tubman Command. Unless I missed, it seems like a big part of this book, as I said, this is not focused on Harriet Tubman, Underground Railroad. This is focused on her efforts during the Civil War, her work as a scout. The big, I guess, major plot theme of the book, the Combi River Raid, and Harriet Tubman's role in this part of the Civil War. Why did you make that the main plot of your work, of fiction?
Well, I think because I think we underappreciate the many dimensions of Harriet Tubman's life. Her work on the Underground Railroad is the best known, but she really had, you know, three phases of her life, and these are the things that make her, I think, you know, the greatest female patriot in American history. And this is the reason why I think that the move to put her on the $20 bill was more than justified. And I say again, as a historian who's, you know, taught American history from, you know, the founding of the, you know, the first colonies up to the present, and have really talked a lot about a variety of Americans. And so with Harriet Tubman, I think that we just don't get it, that here she was a veteran who later received veterans pay, that she was the first American woman to command a small unit of scouts to develop develop the intelligence for a major military raid of the American Civil War. And then she did have this third phase of her life where she was a philanthropist and a women's suffragist. So she, you know, just this amazing woman. And I just think the other part of this is simply that raid is an absolutely rocking story. I mean, it's not just heroic and, you know, brave and all of that, but it's just filled with great daring. I mean, she was a woman who really was a master of spycraft. You know, what, you know, if you're talking with people from the CIA, you know, they would talk about spycraft, you know, the ability to travel behind lines, to travel into dangerous areas, to develop intelligence that later has plays a major military role. So, you know, I just thought it'd be such a fun story to tell and help us all really come to identify with her more strongly than we do.
Do you I guess, any research or affiliation with the CIA?
No, but I was about 10, 15 years ago, I sat on the Historical Advisory Committee of the U.S. State Department for 6 years. And in that capacity, our job was to basically review the records of the U.S. government and make sure we were being transparent to the extent possible, about our foreign policy. And so some of the records we did a lot of review of were records of the CIA. And so in that capacity, you know, one of the things I learned about was, you know, what they call, you know, sources and methods, spycraft. One of the elements of Americans' foreign policy that is generally not revealed through declassified documents are things that would betray what are the ways in which spies find information. Because if you did that, then you would be putting people's lives at risk. And so I just found that very interesting for me as a historian. I think we tend to not really use the terms that are properly used to describe someone like Harriet Tubman. You know, the kinds of things that she was doing were of a caliber that, you know, done by a man, done by a white man, done in a different era would, you know, merit a different kind of description. People would be talking about her, you know, her military abilities and that kind of thing. And I think we need to use those terms with Harriet Tubman.
Mm. Context of White Supremacy, our guest, Dr. Elizabeth Cobbs. I'm pretty sure if a black male had done those things, that could be pretty easily obscured and has been. We've had a number of programs talking about black males who have served in, you can pick World War II, just pick the conflict where their efforts have been obscured. And I raise that because I think you said before, male-dominated society, something close to that. And I did want to make sure I got that out emphatically. I do not think that that is accurate as a black male. What do I dominate?
The reason why I put that, and I'm not going to answer that question directly because I don't want to personalize it to you, but
I would like to know. Male-dominated.
Let me just give you one example of this. The U.S. colored troops, as they were called at the time, you know, obviously did not get the recognition fully that they should have. And I'm glad you brought up, I mean, we could talk about World War I or World War II, various conflicts in which black soldiers really did not get the proper recognition that they deserved. Harriet Tubman had a double, you know, burden to carry in that respect, though, too. Let me give you an example. One of her scouts that served with her, a man, their accounts corroborate each other, so it's very interesting for a historian. As you said, we're always looking for clues in these haystacks, and we have very little to go on sometimes. But anyway, Walter Plowden, a black man, after the war, applied to the U.S. Congress for a pension. Now, by the way, white supremacists, Southerners, in particular, you know, tried to beat down that application and tried to deny him his fair recognition, but he did get it. The Congress gave him a pension within about, you know, a year or two of the war. Harriet Tubman, who served in a much, you know, more prominent capacity and led men, unlike Walter, who was one of her subordinates, you know, it took her 30 years to get a pension. So I think of that as happening not because she was black, but because she was a black woman in that case. So I think that there are just, to me, there are layers in any society of power. You know, somebody who's very wealthy has more power than somebody who's very poor. Somebody who's white has more power than somebody who's black. A man has more power than a woman does, often. Not always, but, you know, that's, if you stack it up, that's how it works. If you look at how much people are paid, you know, gender plays a big role.
Love it. Love it. I didn't mean to interrupt, but I love that one. I love that. Did you have more to respond to that?
No.
Okay.
I didn't want to go on and on.
Much about buckets of words. Dr. Cobbs, I'm so reminded at the University of Texas A&M, we've been here for a decade. One of our more prominent guests over that decade, also at the University of Texas A&M, philosophy department, Dr. Tommy Curry, his book in my top 10, Not Fiction, The Man Not. Oh, my goodness. The main theme of the book, you don't have male domination in a system of white supremacy where black males at no time have more power. And I just, to remind our listeners, we're talking to Dr. Elizabeth Cobbs. Hopefully we'll get a moment we could talk about her documentary, PBS, Cyberwork, and the American Dream. She just talked about her work with the U.S. government. making sure, ensuring transparency, 6 years. This sounds like a very powerful white woman. New York Times best-selling author, powerful white woman in a system of racism, white supremacy. I contend, and especially bringing up the labor statistics, that just ain't so. And that is directly in the man not. White women consistently make more money than black males, even to your point about Harriet Tubman and her compensation. It was not black males who had any say in what she was going to be paid or whether they were going to be paid. I've heard some of your lectures where you even talked about that, where some of the black males had to go and beg and do the same thing and hope that white people did right by them in compensation. That is a system of racism, white supremacy. Well, just ask our listeners to use logic as we continue to move through the book, because some of these points will come up in the book. One of the important points, or it's a term rather, I use the term already, I substituted. I think I was going to say they were going to free the slaves, and I stopped and I said contraband. That is an important term that comes up in the book. Can you explain just why the use of that term, both in the historical concept of why the importance of that term, contraband, in talking about slaves in the South?
Yeah, sure. In the, you know, when the war first started, it's always this interesting contradiction to me. You know, people will point out that the North didn't go to war with the South to stop to end slavery, and that's absolutely true. But the reverse isn't true, which is that to say that the South did go to war to defend slavery. You look at all the declarations of secession of the major Southern states. I mean, they say really clearly that's why they are going to war. The North doesn't do that, though. And it becomes about slavery, so to speak, about halfway through the war. But what happens, and one of the reasons, one of the consequences of that is when black people are first escaping across the lines, to freedom. And when they're also, in a way, accidentally liberated, as they were on the Sea Islands of South Carolina, which is where my book is set, what happened is this crazy thing, Gus, where they didn't want to say, or Lincoln did not want to say, well, these people are just free. Clearly, we freed them. And so they tried to develop a justification for why they were doing it, not because they were eliminating slavery per se, but because the slaves were, could help the Confederacy by, making things, by growing cotton, by growing food, by, assisting in all the ways that they had always done with the Southern economy. And so they said that, if we actually liberate these people, what we're doing is we're taking the property of the other side. And in the rules of war, the rules of engagement historically going back, several hundred years, if you could take the enemy's property, I'm putting that in quotes, if it was a form of contraband, if it would help them prosecute the war on their side. And so for a good long time, up until at least 1863, until the Emancipation Proclamation, people who were liberated were, depending on where they were called contraband. It was a kind of a legal fiction, but that was the term that was used to describe them. I hope that's clear.
Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest, Dr. Elizabeth Cobbs. Just to be specific, what problem did you think you could specifically address with writing this work of fiction about Harriet Tubman?
Well, I thought there were several things that were interesting about it. One is just that, to me, as she was going to, she was slated to go on the $20 bill, which I, was very excited about. And I just thought to myself that if this was going to, be popular with all of the American public as much as we can, aside from people who are, diehard in their and racist convictions, but, for people who don't think about it enough, as we were talking about earlier, that it would be just really great to get more about Harriet Tubman out there so that books, the books are often sold at Costco or Target, or so it's, you know, so often academic books stay on university shelves. You know, I wanted to write something which, you know, people would read at the beach. So there were sort of two thoughts I had here, one of which was, you know, what can we do to make this story more exciting, more interesting, you know, to folks who otherwise don't think a lot about it. And I also wanted to, I thought it was interesting as well to try to use fiction, as you were saying, to kind of walk my own way through a story where we don't have all the pieces. And let me mention I write both fiction and nonfiction, but my preceding fiction book was about Alexander Hamilton. And when I started it, you know, this was before the play came out and made him so popular. But I was very interested in the subject, and I thought, wow, this, you know, such a great story. And one of the things we don't really know about Alexander Hamilton, which is fairly famous about him, which is that he cheats on his wife, a woman with whom he was passionately in love. So it's kind of like a weird mystery, and you don't know if you just want to hate him for it, or, you know, or if, you know, if there's some better explanation. So one of the interesting things about writing fiction is that historians, you know, all we can say is, well, gosh, we don't know. You know, on the one hand this, and on one hand that. Whereas when you write fiction, you have to kind of follow the clues and walk through the story at the pace at which people lived it, to try to ferret out exactly what happened. And so, you know, in the case of their marriage, you know, I walked through it at a pace which I think revealed things about it that historians had not commented on. In the case of Harriet Tubman, this again is one of those things where we've got bits and pieces about the Cumbie River raid. We don't have anywhere a full military record of it. And in fact, the man, the white officer who was in charge of the raid, never wrote more than one paragraph about it. So you can't go to that and say, oh, she did it or she didn't do it, you know, or this is how it happened. And there are some people, and, you know, I think racism is at base, the reason for it, you know, challenge whether this even really happened. So to me, it was important to, you know, to reason through how it could have happened and how I think it did happen.
This would be one where my question didn't get answered, if concisely as possible. What problem were you trying to solve with this work of fiction about Harriet Tubman?
Lack of information.
Lack of information. Okay. And you mentioned that beach metaphor. That's fascinating. I guess that's maybe a new one. Sometimes when people, if they like use certain metaphors, that'll just be a part of their particular vernacular and certain phrases that they use. But with this book specifically, I've heard you a couple times describe this as hopefully being a book that's accessible enough that people could like take this and read at the beach, which it's just interesting to me because this is not a book I would think about like, oh, we're going to go to the beach, which I love to do. Like, I'm going to read this book. And I've read some interesting things at the beach. Like, a white person writing a book of fiction about Harriet Tubman is not a book I read at the beach. But what audience, like, who did you have in mind is going to be reading this book at the beach? White people, non-white people, everybody?
Well, you know, of course, I hope everybody finds it interesting. I think probably a lot of people won't read it at the beach. But, I write novels as well as nonfiction. And I guess the distinction for me is when I was a kid, I loved historical fiction. Because to me, it was the sort of thing that you read, you know, in a way for just the joy of reading it. You know, you weren't reading it because someone told you, you got to sit here and, you know, master something difficult and stuff all these facts into your head. And so, so who will read it? You know, I hope everybody will read it. Everybody who thinks, I hope some people will read it because they think I need to know more about Harriet Tubman. I hope other people will read it because they say, I love mystery books. I hope some people read it because they say, you know, I just love Civil War stuff. I hope some people read it because they'll say, I love romance and I want to know what this woman's life was like, what it was like to be Harriet Tubman as a woman. So I think that readers read things for all kinds of reasons, in all kinds of places.
Fascinating. Fascinating. Just for our listeners, I would not read a book like this at the beach, even though I did read it here, but I was not at the beach because any white woman, white man, or white child who wrote a book about Harriet Tubman, fiction or non, that would be a book that I would, it would not be a leisurely read. I'd put it that way. That would be something that I would be examining because I would have suspicion. We already talked about that. Dr. Cobbs agreed. I would have suspicion. I would have to take this a bit more seriously than, oh, we're just kind of messing around at the beach. Let me read a few pages. Like, that's why I wouldn't read this at the beach. You in the book, oh man, John Brown, in our decade on the air, I have gotten in trouble over John Brown. We've had so many conversations about a white man who has been dead almost 200 years. On this here broadcast, and you even had the song, John Brown's Body Lies. Do you know how many people have come on this program and sung that song? I chuckled, like, 200 years later, and people have chided me for not being properly respectful of John Brown, and wow. One major content. That's why I said I could not read this book at the beach because this would be serious. I would expect a white person to practice racism, white supremacy, especially a white person who sounds like, you know, they're offering some contention. They're not easily admitting, oh, yeah, system of white supremacy, white women dominate too, especially a white person, male or female, who's even sounding like, oh, it's male domination. You black males are somehow in this too. That, whoa, got to read this super serious with a magnifying glass. So when I'm reading this book and hearing about these helpful white people and we got an homage to John Brown and all of this, like, whoa, I am accustomed to reading nonfiction. I had to stop and I said, where's that quote from Edward Baptist? I know you've read The Half Has Never Been Told. Yes.
I don't know that one.
Oh, my goodness. My goodness. Incredible. Edward Baptist, The Half Has Never Been Told. We read that in the book club. It came out in 2014.
Oh, yeah. See, I know of it, but I haven't read it. Nope.
You should read it. It is almost in my top 10. It's right, like, maybe it should be. It gets referenced all the time. We read it in the book
club.
Well,
yeah.
Hang on one second, because I want to make sure I get this quote in. I needed balance because I felt that your book, and it's not just your book, this is a pattern. This is very typical. System of white supremacy, misrepresentation of white people, and really pussyfooting and making it seem like there were a lot more white people who were vested in black people than there were. I went back to Edward Baptist. I said, where is that passage at? And I said, oh, bing. Edward Baptist writes, enslaved migrants, he's talking about black people, enslaved migrants, ran away all the time, hiding in the woods to escape violence. The number, not surprisingly, peaked during cotton picking season, but most of them eventually came back to the slave labor camp. Slave patrols caught them. Random whites caught them. Other slaves betrayed them. Most of them didn't know the way back to wherever they had come from. And in between stood thousands of armed white people who would not be their friends. Oh, just that sentence alone, like, bang, Edward Baptist. As for the free states, they were even farther away. The number of enslaved migrants who made it from the depths of the cotton and sugar frontiers all the way to the free states probably numbered under 1,000 during all the years of slavery. That amounts to 0.1% of all slaves. And I'll stop there. The Half Has Never Been Told, almost in my top 10. Maybe it should be. That is one major critique I have of your book. You do have, you know, some racist white people there, but it does seem like there are a number of helpful, quote unquote, white people in the book. And I just don't feel that that is historically accurate at all.
Well, you know, I think it is. I think that you have to look at someone like General Hunter or Thomas Wentworth Higginson or Colonel James Montgomery, and then those are the people who are in the book. I mean, they were there. They were there, and they were, you know, leading troops, and their goal was to they were all abolitionists. I mean, they were, but, you know, you're totally right. They're a small percentage, very small percentage of Northern white troops.
It can't be
both.
See, that's one I got to stop there, because you said at the beginning, that's not what you said. You said, I think there were, as though I was wrong, and then you said you were right. That's why I said it's got to be, don't pussyfoot, it's got to be unequivocal.
Oh,
either I'm correct
or
I'm not, especially on this point.
That's...
Especially only because what you just said, it's a small number. If it's an anomaly, then it should be representative of the fact that white people collectively, with a few exceptions, you can cite the numbers, we can sing John Brown's hymns and all of that, but with a few exceptions, is Mr. I'll put it this way, is Mr. Baptist, what I just read, is he incorrect?
No, of course okay. He's correct. But you see, and maybe this is the difference between those of us who like fiction and those of us who want to, you know, prefer nonfiction like yourself. If you're talking in generalities, as you are, I absolutely agree with you. If you're talking about a story where you're telling the day-to-day life experience of somebody, you have to look at the people she knew, the people who were in her world. And those included absolutely racist, you know, horrific, you know, overseers and slave plantation owners and racist white troops. All those guys are there and they're all represented in the book. But the people she collaborated with who were very important to her and who enabled her to be successful, you know, participated in her success, they worked together, were these white guys. So I'm not going to, as a novelist, you know, hide their role. That would not enable me to tell her story.
I just want to make it clear, I am not asking her to hide a role or how the story should be written. What I am saying, though, is that white people consistently, and this is what I contend is a major act of racism, they will get a lot of hyperbole and exaggerate these anomalies that they claim were against racism, as opposed to just being as blunt as Mr. Baptist was. And in fact, Edward Baptist got in trouble. There was scandal when this book was published, the paragraph that I just read. There were white people who said Edward Baptist had the audacity to write a book about slavery where all the white people were bad and slave-owning racists, or if not slave-owning racists, they supported it and were racist. He had the audacity to write a book where all the black white people were bad and against black people. And that pretty much, the paragraph I just read, that is pretty much the case. If that's accurate, that's the way we should be talking when we talk about slavery, Harriet Tubman, or whatever else. It should be that these white people, helpful or no, put that in quotes, they are anomalies. Next, you in a lecture, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think I got it. You in a lecture, use the metaphor. I encourage listeners all the time, metaphors, you got to be mindful. Use the metaphor to describe Harriet Tubman. You said she was like, excuse me, Mother Teresa, Spiderman, Queen Latifah, all in one. I said, my goodness, what does that mean? I have got to ask.
Well, I guess what I was trying to convey is she's a superhero. She was renowned for her extraordinary human compassion, and that's the Mother Teresa part. The Queen Latifah part, I guess, is just, you know, when I'm thinking of somebody who is proud and, forthright and has a good sense of humor, which I know that sounds crazy, but, Harriet Tubman apparently possessed a really good sense of humor. So when you're trying to think of it in a way that will communicate to a broad audience of white people and black people and Asians and Hispanics or whatever, you're trying to appeal to modern culture here, popular culture, to identify people who are well known. So that's why, you know, I use that metaphor.
Interesting. Two of those folks are fictional, at least in my process. Spider-Man is a fictional character. I don't know him. Queen Latifah, she didn't say Dana Owens. Like, that's a real person. Queen Latifah is kind of a stage persona, yes?
You know, that's just how I've always, you know, heard her. I mean, that's how she's usually referred to. I don't know her biography well. But I think if I use that phrase, people would know who I'm talking about. I mean, the same way that you would say Cher or someone else who's known primarily by their stage name.
Gotcha.
So, I mean, I think she's a very positive. Do you like Queen Latifah? I mean, I think she's great. So I was searching for metaphors which I think would resonate with people.
Oh, I don't have a problem with Queen Latifah at all. I don't know her, but I don't have a problem. I was just, what a comparison. I said, got to ask about that one. As I read the book, Not at the Beach, Dr. Tommy Curry came to mind regularly. His book, again, The Man Nut, Race, Genre, and Problems of Black Masculinity. He talks about representation of black males on a pretty regular basis. And you talked about the book, you know, it's fiction. I've said that a number of times, try to make that in for emphasis one of the few times. So we're reading fiction. But you have a character in your book, Pipkin. Hope I'm saying his name correctly. He's one of the kind of black overseer folks here in South Carolina who's charged with disciplining some of the black people, you know, managing things, which is totally accurate according to the record, unless I've been misinformed. Right on. We got this character. I think you acknowledged that you fictionalized one of the scenes where one of the black slaves, they're chasing, trying to get away, contraband, trying to escape, and he shoots them. That's a fictional scene, but certainly, you know, based on records, absolutely took place. But I'm reading and I'm looking at the different ways that black males are talked about, portrayed in the book, even the way the book starts off. You start the book with Harriet Tubman talking about, I'm going to have to leave my husband, John. I love him. He's a free man, but I got to go. And she's talking about this decision and why she cannot agree to stay and postpone her escape. And from there, I just looked at some of the different lines that are in the book in terms of representation of black males. I collected about four quotes here I can read quick. The plantation had no good men at all. I'll read it the way it's written. The plantation had no good men at all. My old man, he's so weak, a baby child chop firewood faster. I scoutin' a better man this time. Down here, they thick as fleas. Handsome bucks, Carolina grows them good. Now, I will give context. This is when Harriet Tubman is talking to officers. So she is doing some acting here. This is a part of her spy craft or spy work to kind of get through to put on this act of being a black person. But it's important for context. How many times do we get this repetition? Continuing. She's right to be frightened, the old woman interrupted. An octoroon like Ida will be soiled before sunup around all those loose men. They say that there's more than 600 runaways in the barracks on Hilton Head. Harriet knew the awful dowager was correct, though she refused to agree. Without family, the girl courted a dire fate. Etta's fair complexion and naive air. That word fair again. Pipkin also, I'm not reading the line, but Pipkin also, there's a scene where it looks like he's going to be one to get a slice of the pie to sexually abuse a young, like, teenage girl. It'd be rape, no question about it. But I mean, like, child rape. This is like a teen girl. We've talked about that so much on the program, and white men and white women, Dr. Curry, raping black males, black females, black children. Next, you write, Harriet lifted one end. A large spider scrambled into the canvas folds of the opposite corner, though not before Harriet spied the red hourglass on its black abdomen. She grimaced, mad at the world, overrun by spiders and troublesome men. She had no time to waste on either. She calls Samuel a coward. It's a lot of points in the book where it's like, wow, the representation of black males is not quality in this text. Do you have thoughts or response?
Yeah, well, first of all, I mean, one thing you got altogether wrong, because Pipkin is white, the man who's described as, you know, being predatory towards that young girl.
Thank you.
Which he was.
Thank you.
So that's clear. I think you might have just read that quickly, because he's a white overseer. And then as to others, yeah, the first quote you gave is, Harriet is herself appealing to racist stereotypes. She's trying to convince two white patrollers who, you know, are going to, you know, round her up, or are going to, you know, harm her. And she's trying to convince them that, you know, that she's this harmless woman. And so she exaggerates. She plays right into their racist expectations and uses those kind of terms in order to make them think that she's harmless. The other, in terms of Harriet's general relationship with men, well, first of all, she works mostly with black men, you know, in her life, truly, and also also in this book. Her scouts are all black men, and they're all, you know, men she loves. I mean, who I think are portrayed very positively, because, you know, that's historically who they were. Now, that said, Harriet Tubman did have problems with her first husband, and she talked about that. I'm just basically using the documentation that Harriet provided to the woman she selected to be her biographer. And there, what she said was, you know, how heartbroken she was when he refused to come with her. And he, as you know, was a free man. He was in a difficult situation too. I think it's hard for any of us to judge why somebody does or doesn't do what they're, you know, why he didn't go with his wife, for example, and why, you know, when she came back for him, he wouldn't even talk to her. As a woman, she was upset by that. And I think that our personal feelings are not all of them have to be subject to a political analysis. I just don't think. I mean, I think that being human transcends that.
I think anything involving humans is going to be political. Like, that's not even logical, the last portion of what you just said. But be that as it may, I totally acknowledge my error with Pipkin. Thank goodness. I'm so glad. That makes me feel a little bit better. But the point, in my view, is still there. As I said, the book starts with this representation of John, which does not exactly come off as like, oh, wow, yeah, this is a great black male. Like, he's not really, he's kind of holding me back. He's a dead weight. In fact, he gets described as evil. It was right. That was one. I didn't even highlight all. Oh, I didn't read all of the highlights that I pointed out. I was like, wow, this consistently, the way that black males are being referenced, where she has this conversation with one of the other slaves early on. That's what happened when you reckon with white Dollar. Septimus mouth fell open. Killer. What, did I get the right one? Yes, I did. Yes, I did.
You know, I don't remember the word evil, but, you know, I'm not.
Not evil. It was right. Gaffa. She called her Gaffa.
Oh, yeah. Right. No, because the other woman, the Gullah woman.
Septima.
You know, she uses, right, Septima. She uses the term to say, you know, that man's, you know, he's a bad man. He's evil. And Harriet says, no, you know, he wasn't evil. He was just weak. I thought, you know, and I think that's how
she thought of him. Samuel as well. I'm just saying it comes up regularly.
Well, I think she falls in love with him. I think he's a complex person, and ultimately, he, you know, it's, you know, at least how I portrayed him, and he is kind of a combination of a made up character. Not, I mean, he was a real person, but we don't know that he had it. What his relationship specifically was like with Harriet on a personal level. But, I mean, he's a man who ultimately decides, who does something very strong. You know, he gives up a woman he loves to take care of children, you know, to be a good father to his boys. So, I think it's complex. It's just very human. And that was my goal in writing the book, not to paint everybody as either, you know, all white people are bad or all black people are angels. You know, neither of those is true. But we need to understand, you know, the depth of the evil of slavery. And that's certainly something I was trying to get across. One thing you didn't mention is, but I used a lot of the, what were known as the WPA slave narratives taken in the 1930s, where people who, you know, had lived through slavery and were still alive, their testimony was taken. So that's a lot of what I used to describe some of the most, I think, painful episodes in the book.
You have a lot of quotes in the book from some of your sources in the chapter and what have you. And you talked about, I think I've heard that you talked about that in a lecture as well, in sourcing the material. I could talk about the male thing later. Unless I am misinformed, when you spoke about part of writing this book, I think you mentioned it several times already. I didn't even have it in my notes to write about the $20 bill portion, but you said in 2016, I guess, sometime around the election, or maybe after the election, because I think you said that your conclusion after all of that was that it's hard to be a leader as a woman. And that was a part of the motivation in going to this book. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, I was interested in different elements of Harriet's experience. And I think that leading men, as for a woman, presents specific challenges. And so that's kind of what I was, that was another part of what I thought would be fun to explore.
Okay. When I heard that about the different, like I said, it sounded as if it was said after the election was done, Hillary lost. My takeaway from that, the conclusion, number one, predicted, Dr. Welsing predicted he was going to win, knew this was happening, system of white supremacy. Equally important, same thing I've said already on the broadcast, it is not a patriarchy. Donald Trump would not have won without white women. 52% of white voting women voted for Trump across all demographics. That was my major takeaway after all of that, in the middle of Me Too and everything else. white women, they made their choice. And I think they're going to make their choice again. I've said the entire time, 4 more years, I've never had any doubt. Line up anybody you like. Do you have any thoughts on 52% of white women voting for Trump 2016?
Yeah, to me, that's more a confirmation of patriarchal attitudes, honestly, than proof that that patriarchy doesn't exist. I think that part of what happens for women is that they don't always know their own interests. I think that can be a problem, in most social movements. That's what I think about it. And I think it's just the things he said about women, the ways he was towards women, primarily white. I mean, those the women who came forward were almost all white, that I recall, and treated them, assaulted. actually assaulted some women, so they claimed. And yet women voted for him. So to me, that would be more to confirm, the belief that that's okay. That's what patriarchy is, which is the assumption, the assertion, rather, that this kind of proprietary behavior by men towards women is fine. It's what God ordains. And I don't agree with that.
That, I know if someone made that response, if we were talking about voting patterns, because people do that a lot, and oh buddy, they're going to get ready to do that for an entire calendar year. But talking about voting patterns, if someone were to look at the results of any election, and they were talking about black people, and however they voted said that they don't know their own self-interest, wow. I'm not sure I would accept that argument at all. I do not accept that argument with white women either, that they don't know their own interest, self-interest, in a system of racism, white supremacy, particularly when you had a candidate. Yeah, he said a whole lot about females during his candidacy. He also said a lot about non-white people and black people. And I'm pretty sure that those white women heard that too. And I think white supremacy, I've already concluded what the dominant motivating force in the known universe is. And I think white women make their choices based on what is most important to them, just like anyone else. But I guess I'll ask listeners, you can evaluate that if you think that white women have a difficulty ascertaining what is in their best interest, particularly when they go to vote. Let's see. I will pause.
Well, for example, I don't think it was in the best interest of our country. And I think that people who made that selection, selected a candidate who's now up for impeachment, who has, used his personal office for, personal financial gain. Is that in their interest? Is that in the interest of anybody who doesn't actually, get some of that money? I just don't think it is. So that's why I say that I think that people don't always vote in their own self-interest. Just don't.
Well, you didn't say people first time. You said white women specifically. It wasn't a general statement, but be that as it may.
Well, yes, because you're asking me about them.
Be that as it may, that's not my assessment. I'll just say again, 4 more years. What I was going to say, since we did have folks who were aware of Dr. Cobb's work prior to today, they had already, I guess, checked it out and what have you. I don't know if they read the whole thing or not, but if you all have questions, the number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943, pound, press *61 if you would like to participate. I'll get in one more. The romance, because you included that this is fiction. Again, there's a fictionalized romance between Harriet Tubman, Samuel, black male. He's in with this whole, the scouts that are going to do the work, the Combi River Raid. And they have this fictionalized romance, even though he has a, I don't even know if you call it a wife under slavery. Put that in quotes. He has a wife. Put that in quotes. She is on a plantation. He's trying to get her as well. They have children, so he's trying to get his slave family members. He's trying to rescue them as well. And so you have this fictionalized account, and there's some, what would I call it? Steamy romantic scenes, I'll put it that way. Nothing X-rated, but I mean, it's there. Folks can read it. And I thought of the Delectable Negro, Vincent Woodard, also in my top 10. Full title, Human Consumption and Homoeroticism in U.S. Slave Culture. And I thought, wow, this is another, those sex or not sex. Well, yes, it is. The romance themes. That would be another reason why I couldn't really read a book like this at the beach, because I paused and I said, now I'll have to pause and think about this. Now we have a white author, suspected racist, writing a fictionalized, sexualized scene with Harriet Tubman. You even had a pass. You had that in the author's note at the end. I read that. You said you questioned. I don't know what Harriet Tubman would think about me being a white woman writing this book about her. I had that like, wow, we get to this scene like, wow, what do I think about that? I don't know what other folks, I don't know folks who've read the book or not, but a white woman writing this fictionalized sex scene with Harriet Tubman in the middle of the Civil War. And I thought of Delectable Negro and I said, wow, I could see an audience for racists who would like consuming this sort of thing. There's a lot of racial pornography. We had that program last year. Dr. Wood, she's right here in the University of Washington at Tacoma. We had her on the program that's long on the system of racism, white supremacy. Did you have any thoughts, concerns? Have you been questioned about the steamy kind of romance scenes there?
You know, it's this is something, of course, I thought a lot about. I actually think it's a compliment to Harriet Tubman. I think Harriet Tubman was a beautiful woman. She was described as, you know, as a very pretty woman. She was a person who was married twice, who had a great heart, you know, who so often, you know, we remember Harriet Tubman for what she did for everybody else. But I think part of her being really human is that, you know, she wanted a life for herself as well. So in that sense, to me, it's a measure of respect. I had to tell you, not because she was black, but because she's famous more than anything else. I had the same question in my mind when I wrote about fictionalized stories about Alexander Hamilton, or before him, Charles Francis Adams, who was the grandson of John Adams, about whom I wrote my first novel. And in all of them, I mean, these are fiction. I have portrayed romantic scenes with all of the characters. These are all people we know who were married, and so I'm pretty sure that, you know, they all, you know, had, you know, the bedroom was a part of their life. So in that sense, to me, it's not consuming Harriet Tubman or in any way inappropriately sexualizing her. But, you know, of course, I don't know. Nobody knows how people would think of how they're portrayed. You know, I do know that Harriet Tubman, this happens to be a fact, when she hired somebody to write her autobiography, she hired a white woman who was an abolitionist. She didn't ask Frederick Douglass. I don't know why. So my hope is that that readers won't start out by saying, as you just said, now this is a racist white author.
That is not what I said. Hang on. That is not what I said. That is not what I said. Hold, whoa. And there's inappropriate laughter. That is something I take very serious. I've talked about this repeatedly on the program. Black people have been killed for talking about racism. I never, this is a decade, I never just throw out, oh, this is a racist white woman. I never say that. And there is a, I'll explain all of that later. I just want to make sure that that's on the record. That is not what I said, and I think you're practicing racism, white supremacy deliberately by not quoting me accurately. I said suspected racist, as I generally do. Code.
You know, all I can say, I don't have this recorded.
It is
so I'm not
being
playing
recorded.
It back. I'm sure you said it just the way you said it. Imagine you did, because you say it repeatedly. We've just met tonight, so I don't, you know. But I'm just saying, people, I think, understandably wonder, and I hope that in my book I show that I've developed a portrayal of Harriet Tubman which is true to the facts, that is respectful, and that is uplifting, that will make everyone walk away loving Harriet Tubman even more than they already do. Because that's my goal.
Suspected racist, Dr. Elizabeth Cobbs, star 6-1. If you have questions, especially, I guess, if we have any folks who read the book before, if you got to the sex scene that I'm talking about, feel free, chime in if you have thoughts about that or anything else, if you actually did get an opportunity to check out the book prior to the broadcast. Let's see. Person who dialed in, Black African. Did you have a question for Dr. Cobbs? You should be with us.
Yes. I had two quick questions. My first question is about, like, the, I guess, Harriet, like, her image. It's a bit, like, on the $20 bill, and then also, I remember in Washington, D.C., I would see her image when they were building the African-American, the sort of Museum of African-American History. I would sort of, like, the complex was surrounded with a tarp, and it had her image everywhere. And so I'm just wondering, like, why would, I guess with you as well, and, like, the people that were, like, why would white people use this lady's image, especially as you said, like, I think you said that she isn't well known, like her history. So I'm just wondering, like, why would her image be used so much?
Yeah, that's a good question. Well, I think it's because people who know the history think that she's, you know, a great heroine, that that, you know, we should put her forward as kind of the face. In a way, the way, in fact, when it was proposed that she would go on the $20 bill, she'd be the face of all American women, whether they're white or black or, you know, whatever background people are from. Because she's, you know, she is well known. She actually won a national contest to be on the $20 bill. This was something like 700,000 people voted nationwide, selecting from amongst, I think, 20 or so famous women, from wives of the presidents, like Eleanor Roosevelt to Rosa Parks to Clara Barton, who was a white nurse in the Civil War. And out of all those people, Harriet Tubman was voted to be the person to represent all of us women. I'm speaking here as a woman. So I think that's the reason why. And one of the other things, and I'm not sure which particular pictures you saw, sir, but one of the pictures that's gotten a lot of play lately is one that was just recently discovered of when Harriet Tubman was a fairly young woman, about the same age she was as I portray her in my book, meaning she was around 40 years old. And it's just lovely, lovely photograph that no one had seen for, you know, 150 years. So it's gotten a lot of attention.
Did you say that Harriet Tubman is going to represent all women, including white women?
Yes. Well, you know, if you think of, in a sense, if you think of who's on our dollar bills, right? You know, we have the $1 bill and the $5 bill and the $10 bill, you know, the 20, et cetera. And those people were selected, like Abraham Lincoln, George Washington, Andrew Jackson, Alexander Hamilton, in the case of those bills, as being kind of like, you know, symbols for our country. This is true, by the way, in other countries as well. You know,
I guess, sorry, I'll change my...
Sure.
How does Harriet Tubman represent white women?
Well, because in the same way that George Washington is supposed to be the founder of our country, which belongs to everybody who's a citizen of the country, in that sense, he represents all of us, he represents the country. Harriet Tubman was selected to represent American women. That was the purpose of the exercise, because we're the only major democracy in the world that doesn't have a woman on its paper currency. So, you know, go to Mexico, go to Australia, go to Canada, go to, you know, almost anywhere, and you'll find women on the currency to represent the women of the country. So Harriet Tubman was selected to be the only woman on our nation's currency, and therefore representing all women, including a woman like me.
Okay, thank you. My last question, mm-hmm. because you are a white woman and you're also an educator, I was wondering, due to, I believe white women represent the majority of teachers in the U.S., and due to the really, really poor or horrific educational outcomes, especially of black people. What do you think, how can I phrase this? Do you think that white women should not be allowed to teach black children?
No, I don't think so. I wouldn't say that that's our solution to the abysmal state of American education. Any more than I would say that black women shouldn't teach white children. I think it's really important that all of us do our very best to make our country better. So, is, in a sense, I think what you're asking is education bad because white women are teaching kids? I don't think that that's probably the reason. I think most people who look at the economics of education say one of the reasons why education is so bad is we don't pay teachers, period, enough. You know, we need to be paying enough so that, you know, the very best people of whatever race get out there and teach. Maybe if salaries are higher, it would motivate more black women to enter that profession and more black men. That would be fantastic. But in terms of having enough teachers to teach all of the numbers of children we have, I think we're going to need everybody, but we need the very best people.
Okay, thank you.
Much obliged, the black African. Let's see, caller Tapello, did you have a question for Dr. Cobbs? You should be with us.
Greetings.
Greetings.
Let me try to power through this. I've heard you make some very questionable statements. The number one statement is about, well, let's just get some definitions down. Number one, what is your definition of a black person in the context of the Racial Integrity Act?
I guess I don't really understand your question. Yeah, are you asking me to comment?
Are you, you did claim that you write history books, did you not?
Oh, yeah, yeah, no, I have a number of history books.
And we're talking about slavery systems and you're talking about the history of the United States. Are you not familiar with the Racial Integrity Act?
Yes, I am. You're talking about...
Okay, so now what is your definition of a black person in the context of the Racial Integrity Act?
Well, the Racial
What is your definition?
Act, I can't use my definition to say this... I don't agree with the Racial Integrity Act. I think most people think that that was a very racist thing. In fact, we know it was. It was to reinforce racial segregation by prohibiting interracial marriage. And, of course, they were classifying white as a person who had no trace of any blood other than Caucasian, which is, as we know, is kind of ridiculous. I mean, if we look at DNA tests today, we know that all of us came from Africa. So all of us have some portion of African ancestry, tiny, 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 might be, you know, hundreds of years later, but thousands of years later. But, you know, I think it's, you know, it's obviously a very racist, it was a very racist piece of legislation. So I wouldn't
What is the Racial Integrity Act? According to the Racial Integrity Act, the Native American was erased from history and made into black people. So are you saying that your definition, that you disagree with that, with that definition of what a black person is, that they are from Africa and not an American?
No, of course not.
So it's quite possible that a black person is a Native American or an Aboriginal or First People.
Right. I think, you know, often when we say black, we mean people who are descended from, you know, people came over from Africa.
Well, let me put it. Let me ask you this question because we're going to get confused. I want to know what's your definition of a white person, because see, we if we're all from Africa, I want to know how come the disparities are so different. If we're all from Africa and white people are from North Africa, how do you explain what a white person is, or the value of a white person? What is your definition of white?
I think white is simply, it's an offhand way we use to refer to people who are primarily from Europe. Although even there, you know, historically that's changed over time. You know, there were people who thought that you had to be from the northern part of Europe to be really fully white. If you were from southern Europe, you weren't. So I don't think that there is any absolute. It's not like
would it be more accurate to say would it be more accurate to say that white means without debt?
Without debt?
A free person.
Well, no, I don't think so. I think that.
So you disagree with the history of the word white and the history of all free white people, or all free people, since the Constitution says?
No, I think that we definitely have, and it's easily shown that white supremacy has been a part of American history for a long time. That when people say the word white, they usually mean people whose ancestors came from Northern Europe. So I don't know what we're disagreeing about.
That's eugenics.
We have other folks who dialed in. I want to make sure we can get all the folks.
Yes, sir. I'll let other people go.
Much obliged. Be in Toronto.
Thank you,
mm-hmm, for sure. Be in Toronto. Did you have a question for Dr. Cobbs?
Yes, I did. Good evening to you, Gus. The guests, callers, and listeners. I just wanted to clear up a couple of things, before I get into the question real quickly. I just wanted to say I've been listening quite closely to the content of the program, and at no time did I ever hear you, Gus, ever make an allegation or a claim that Ms. Cobbs' book was racist. So, Ms. Cobbs, it may be an indictment on what you may actually think about your book, but at no time did I ever hear Gus say that your book was racist or even close to it. Also, going to white women knowing what they wish to support and whom to support. Not only did they support Donald Trump, but they also supported, quite a large number of them, supported Senator Kavanaugh. Who was also well known for using and abusing women. And also, in terms of the comment regarding women getting paid more than men, I have yet to hear white women complain about unemployment, considering that they have benefited the most from affirmative action, gathering stable and high-paying jobs. Much like yourself, Ms. Cobbs, in your position as professor. But let me go into my first question. When Harriet Tubman was alive, she made multiple attempts to escape white terrorism from both white men and white women, and even white children, resulting in the loss of one eye due to beatings, repeated rapes from her being from a child to womanhood, starvation, and having her care unit ripped apart. Care unit is similar to that of family, but under the system of white supremacy, well, we're not allowed to have families if non-white. So her body was commodified because she was essentially a slave, as designated under white supremacy. And Ms. Tubman justly fought against it. So my question is twofold for you, Ms. Cox. Do you have any regard for Ms. Tubman? And second, if so, why do you continue to choose to commodify Ms. Tubman in her death through your historical fiction?
Well, yeah, thank you, Bea, for your call. I am an enormous fan of Harriet Tubman. I just, in fact, part of the reason why I wrote the book was because I really do want to see her on the $20 bill. And, I think that would be a good thing for us all. In terms, so you know, I just don't accept. I don't accept that this is a commodification of her. I think it's, you know, I mean, history. This is what we do. This is what professional historians do. I have a PhD in history. I've written books on a variety of people, and I usually try to select people who I think, have made an interesting and important contribution to our world. So to me, that's, you know, I mean, you may disagree and not like what I'm doing, and I get that, but, you know, I think that what I'm doing is actually very valuable.
I'm sorry, may I just add one more thing just to clarify? Yes, you may have a PhD, and there goes affirmative action, right? There's also the fact that you're saying that you're into historical context. However, I just want to bring back the notion that this is a historical fiction, meaning that it's not true. It's not based in reality. It's based on imagination with some aspects of historical content, meaning that, yes, there was Harriet Tubman, but the situation that was in your book doesn't mean that it actually occurred, except in your imagination. So just to clarify that. Going on with the next question real quickly, you mentioned at the beginning of the program that fiction built empathy. Now, fiction, storytelling, these terms are usually associated with deception. So are you saying that to feel empathy, deception is required? Isn't the Harriet Tubman story the true story? Wouldn't that have been enough to develop empathy for you?
You know, there's some really interesting studies that have been done in the last 6 or 7 years on how our human brains, how we respond when we read fiction as opposed to nonfiction. Just, you know, very, very interesting studies undertaken by, you know, major universities using it basically MRIs. And so what they discovered was that when somebody reads a story, you know, a story can be, you know, based largely on the truth, but it's a story and it's put together in the way that you would simply tell a story, that we are a different part of our brain lights up. And it's the part of the brain that we experience it almost as if we had had an experience. So if you read a story about a rape, for example, you would respond to it more emotionally, more empathetically than if you just read, let's say, a series of statistics about, you know, rape as a problem for Black women, rape as a problem during slavery, that kind of thing. So I think that, you know, to me, there's a value in that. Should people feel more empathetic when they read nonfiction? Yeah, I mean, I'm a historian, so I try to read all of those kinds of things sympathetically. But if what your goal is, and as mine was and is to help people identify more with Harriet Tubman, then, you know, fiction is a way, as long as it's done respectfully and as long as it's done in a way that's consistent with what we do know. So, you know, yes, you're totally right. You have to make some stuff up, like even conversation. You know, nobody has a tape recorder, so, and I, by the way, I want to acknowledge, Gus, I heard you wrong. You said Dr. Cobbs is a suspected white racist, and I was going farther than you intended with that.
That's not what I said either, but.
I just need to add,
not to, to deviate, sure. Because I had one last question. Since we're on the, on that same road of, or that talk of induced trauma, you also mentioned a quote of feel the pain. So what led you to formulate such a phrase? I mean, why must one feel the pain in order to relate to another person? That just doesn't seem logical to me. But yet there's silence on the vile deviancy of white terrorism. Why is that?
Well, you know, I think that one of the problems with terrorism, one of the challenges we have as humans, I mean, one reason why some people are sociopaths, right? A sociopath is somebody who doesn't feel what it's like to be hurt. If they hurt somebody, they don't get it. Like, they think, They don't understand. They don't apply it to themselves. And so I think absolutely racism, particularly slavery and a form of slavery, was based on a very sociopathological, because the planters weren't recognizing these people who were deeply human as human, as human as themselves. So I think if we don't feel each other, recognize each other's feelings, if you cried, you know, it should, if I'm a normal person, stimulate in me a feeling of sadness for you. And similarly, if a person laughs, right, if a person smiles, normally our reaction is to kind of feel along with them. And so what I really wanted to do with Harriet Tubman was to help people feel along with her and respect her more as a result of that, and sort of realize that, you know, she was a vulnerable human being. And when people are vulnerable, one of the things is it does is it, you know, it alerts us to their full humanity.
Hang tight.
Thank you. And I have one. Hang tight, sorry, just B. One last quick question.
Hang tight, B. I wanted to see if we could nab our other folks. I'll circle back and see if we can have time for one more. Thomas in New York, did you have a question you wanted to get in? Have you seen, matter of fact, have you seen Thomas in New York? Let me make sure I get Cyber Work and the American Dream. Have you seen that?
Cyber Work? No, is it a video?
Give us your teaser, Dr. Cobbs. Cyber Work and the American Dream, PBS documentary.
Yes, well, this is nice to meet you, and Mr. Thomas in New York. It's a PBS documentary that I was helped to produce this past year about the future of work in the age of artificial intelligence, and what we need to do as a country to try and get readier to make sure we're taking care of people and that make sure people will have work. So it's a history, but it's also forward looking, and also you know, it's meant to be something which takes some of the fear out. And so there are parts of it which are actually funny. I think a lot of people always can't quite believe me when I say that, because they think anything about artificial intelligence must just be totally scary. And this was just very interesting. We interviewed people, you know, from MIT and Stanford and people working in Silicon Valley on that subject. What is artificial intelligence, basically?
Okay, very good. Thank you very much, Dr. Kyle. Yeah, I do a show, and that's the type of topics that I talk about, but more how this stuff will be used, racist, you know, being programmed by racists, it's going to be the same thing. But yeah, there's going to be no jobs, that's for sure. Have a few questions for you. I'm going to get in as much as I can. And thank you for coming on the show once again. First, you used an analogy earlier. You mentioned George Washington. You knew that George Washington owned slaves. For that very reason, he could never represent me. I don't think that was a very good analogy. I watched your video where you were, I think, giving a lecture or answering questions, and you used a metaphor that I found very troubling. You said, "Fiction lights the dark corners of evidence." And of course, synonyms for fiction is a lie, a fabrication, a fable. Why would you feel as though fiction lights the dark corners of evidence?
Well, I think of it as fiction as being, and I guess the metaphor is like we're in a dark room, right? You know, it's a room where there is a single light on, and there's sort of the dark corners, and you're like, well, what's over there? And to me, one of the things that fiction does is that it helps us to imagine. And I'm not an enemy of imagination. I don't think of fiction as deceitful, as long as you call it fiction, right? You're not saying this is what Harriet Tubman said on this day to this person. I mean, we can't say that about almost anybody very few people have ever lived unless they were recorded, right? You know, we have a tape recording, we can say what people said. Otherwise, it's all made up. So I like fiction because I feel that it helps us to explore what happened. And we have to use our imagination sometimes, to imagination to feel like what it might have been like, you know, when, you know, when Harriet Tubman, you know, she never went south again after the war, and she chose to live her life in the North, and she chose to open up a home for the aged. This was another big part of her contribution as an American patriot. And so, you know, what was she feeling when she did those things? You know, what did it mean to her? And so fiction is an act of imagination to try to guess what happened.
Great. I'm glad you answered that question in exactly that way, because you just said that all historians make up things. And if that's true, how much of U.S. history is true and how much is made up? Can you give us a percentage?
No, because I don't think that is what I said. What I said was that we have fiction and we have nonfiction. Nonfiction, you're not supposed to make anything up, not a thing. You're not supposed to make up a cloud in the sky. If you don't know it was cloudy that day, you can't say it. So where people, I think, and this is, I think, what you are asking is, or I would agree with you, that even when we have facts, we can argue about what they mean. And that's where, you know, you might challenge some, you know, you might challenge an interpretation. You might say, this is a racist interpretation of the facts. The facts, we don't have to, we can agree on the facts, but what they meant, you know, we can ascribe really different meanings to them. And so I think that that's a very, very important conversation to have. And I'm really glad you brought that up. But I don't think you can say, oh, what percentage of the facts in a book are wrong? I think the intent is to get every single one of them right. You know, I try to make, we all trip sometimes, you know, and you write down the page number wrong or something, or, you know, you could spell somebody's name wrong. But I think by and large, in most nonfiction books, you know, the authors try to get them right. Probably most of the time they are. But that does not mean that we would agree with their interpretations all the time.
Got you. You're a college professor. Are you familiar with whiteness studies?
Yes, I am.
What are your thoughts on whiteness studies, if you don't mind me asking?
No, I don't mind at all. That's why I'm here. I think that it's not my specialty, I'm not going to be as conversant in that as some people are. I think that, you know, that it's important in the sense that it's really important to understand, you know, why people behave as they do. And I think a lot of the people in whiteness studies would say what they're trying to understand is, you know, what is this group behavior of white people? You know, why, how do people define being white? Which is actually, you know, a question Gus was raising earlier. You know, what does it mean to be white? Or what does it mean to, you know, define your life in that way? Or, you know, I think it's, to me, these are always valuable questions to explore.
Do you think that the whiteness study serves as its purpose to refine racists on white people who would be maybe less sophisticated at practicing racism? It gives them talking points on racism, like white privilege and things like that?
Well, I think, as I understand whiteness studies, and this is, you know, again, it's not my specialty, but it's looking at, you know, what has produced white privilege. That's how people who do that work describe it, and they oppose it. You know, they oppose white privilege. Pioneers in the field are considered W.E.B. Du Bois, you know, who would certainly, you know, qualify as a black man. You know, somebody who opposed racism was a leader. So, I mean, in that sense, I think that, I guess, anything can be turned back around itself. But it seems to me that the intent of that field is to criticize racism. And particularly, and white, you know, to criticize white racism and white privilege.
Oh, gotcha.
So I didn't watch. That seems worthwhile. I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. No, I was going to say, I didn't watch the movie, but I heard that in the Harriet Tubman movie that just came out, that they have a black slave catcher, and a white male is the hero who saved her. Would you consider that historically accurate?
They had, one of the slave catchers was black. You know, I think that there have been, I think it was very rare. I think that almost all of the patrollers were white, that, you know, I'm aware of. I mean, there were, for example, black overseers, but it, you know, wasn't common. And of course, sometimes people are tempted by money to do things which are immoral. That happens. I know you said you didn't see the movie, and the other, you know, hero of that was a man who was the cousin of that fella, and who came around to help Harriet out. So I think that the major heroes in the film, you know, are all black, or mostly anyway. Certainly, William Still, who's beautifully portrayed. I forget the name of the actor who portrayed him. He was in the Hamilton musical too. But, you know, these are, you know, I think what they were trying to show.
I just wanted to know if that was accurate, if this story that they put out on the silver screen, if it was accurate or if it's fiction.
Oh, okay. No, this part is fictionalized. I thought you were asking kind of like, did that ever happen anywhere? No, in this particular case, there's no evidence that Harriet Tubman went back and was, you know, chased or hounded by a black slave catcher. That did not happen, that we know of. I mean, again, because there's so much that's not documented, you know, we can't say for sure that didn't happen, but Harriet Tubman never said that. There's no evidence for that. It's sort of like Colson Whitehead, you know, yeah, made up parts.
Okay,
of what
my
talking
very
about.
Last question, and thank you, Gus, for being patient with me. you spoke about women's women's suffrage, the women's suffrage movement. Would you put Harriet Tubman and other black women in that movement at that time? Do you think that's historically accurate to say that actually treated? Go ahead.
No, that's historically accurate. I mean, Harriet Tubman was an acquaintance, a friend of Susan B. Anthony, who admired Harriet Tubman. And then spoke well of Harriet Tubman and appeared on Harriet Tubman and appeared. They both lived in upstate New York, where there were a lot of women's suffrage conventions.
But Susan B. Anthony also said that she did not want black people to be able to vote before white women. That she thought that would be an abomination. So I mean, she was definitely a racist. A lot of her viewpoints, a lot of the conferences that they had was segregated. I'm just asking, do you think that's accurate to say that she was treated like she was a part of the team or on the council or making decisions? Well, she might have been someone that they propped up there to put a black woman, but I'm just saying, do you think that's accurate that you that they put Harriet Tubman as a prominent figure in that movie?
You know, I don't think Harriet Tubman was ever used as a prop by anybody. You know, I think she was a very self-possessed person. If she showed up and was there and sat on the, you know, on the dais, you know, in front of everybody, it's because she decided to do that. Did she feel that all those people were all her friends? Probably not. You know, Susan B. Anthony, of course, had been an abolitionist before she became a suffragist, a women's suffragist. And part of what was going on there is that they also felt that it wasn't that they didn't want black people, it was black men. So what they were hoping for was that everybody would be enfranchised at the same time, black women and white women and black men. You know, how do we approve of how they handled it all together? No. But, you know, they certainly did want black women to be enfranchised. Harriet Tubman used to have arguments, apparently, about it with her brother, who didn't think women needed the vote. So, I mean, these things are usually complex.
Context of white supremacy. Patience. Let's see. Retired firefighter, did you have a question for Dr. Cobbs? You should be with us.
First, I will start off saying, yes, it is disrespectful, very disrespectful to speak about someone's sexual life, and the person is deceased. And if she was alive today, more than likely you would have to ask permission. My first question is, what is freedom under the global system of racism, white supremacy? And as the earth is still under the system of racism, white supremacy, why would that be a worthy achievement? Freedom.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. You know, I think for someone like, since I'm a historian, and I'm so that, you know, I always go back to what I know best. I think what's interesting is that for someone like Harriet Tubman, I don't think she thought when she was bringing people north that she was bringing them to a perfect world. I mean, I think she knew that there was a lot of racism in the north, but I think she felt like she was bringing them somewhere much safer. That's why she brought her parents north. Tragically, by the way, her first husband, you know, the one who would not go north with her, was killed after the war, 2 years after the war, just shot in cold blood by a white man when he refused to, I think there was an economic argument, I can't remember now the details of it, but the man shot him in cold blood, and the kid who was staying there right with the guy was unable to testify against him because he was black, the child. So, you know, that system was horrible, and I think that, you know, freedom, meaning that people were not legally enslaved, was an improvement that they sought, that they fought for, that they died for, that Harriet Tubman risked her life for. Is it everything we would want? No, absolutely not. You're completely right about that.
You're stating that the problem is still here, correct?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, second question. Was Ms. Tubman subject to the system of white supremacy?
Well, as an enslaved person, she certainly was.
As her time during a scout? Sorry to interrupt, retired firefighter. What about during her time as a scout? Was she subject to the system of white supremacy during her time as a scout during the Civil War?
Well, I mean, I think that at least I would agree that, you know, white supremacy as a system is something that persists to the present. So anybody alive, you know, anybody who, a person of color in those period of time, you know, was at risk of all kinds of harm because of that system. But, I mean, you know, we were talking about the time when she was, you know, escaping from slavery on the Underground Railroad in particular. But, yeah, any point onward. I mean, she suffered grievously when here she was, a disabled veteran of the war, a hero. And when she traveled north on the train at government expense, as soldiers were allowed to do, at the end of the war, she was told to get off the car and to get into a different car because she was black. And she was like, I'm riding right here. And this wasn't Rosa Parks. This wasn't like they, you know, escorted her off. A conductor beat her up and threw her off the train. You know, this is what happened, and this is the kind of, you know, these are the kinds of dangers that Harriet Tubman faced, and that, you know, most black people, all black people faced. So, you know, there's no question that historically that system was in play for her.
Can you be a woman and a subject to the global system of racist white supremacy at the same time?
You know, I'm sorry, I just don't understand your question.
No problem. I'll state it again. Can you be a woman and subject to the global system of racism, white supremacy at the same time?
Well, sure. Harriet Tubman would be an example of that, who was a woman and subject to that system.
That's it.
Much obliged, retired firefighter. Let's see. Honest John. Wait a minute. Just hold that. Honest J from the D, you are next. But just to sneak in one more passage, since you talked about Harriet Tubman, she didn't think she was sending the black people the contraband that they were liberating to the North where there was no racism. This is reading from the Tubman Command. Harriet spoke across the ward, causing heads to turn. Plenty of folks, she said, ain't no more slaves in the North except ones Southerners bring in. Now, depending on the time period, I don't even think that that is accurate because the slave black people in the North were not freed from the Emancipation Proclamation unless I've been misinformed. So that would, yeah, not. Anyway, continuing. None in Canada. And the folks in England across the ocean, they give it up too. The British Lion swept away them slavers 30 years ago. Freed everybody around the world. America just catching up. I'm skipping over the preacher part, going back to Harriet Tubman. White folks is just folks, she said. Some of the Bukra, this is the Gula dialect. We talked about that before. So some of the Bukra is white people, I think. Bukra are sinful, and they now reaping the wages of sin. They bloodied and bowed, and their end ain't yet in sight. Many is ignorant. Ooh-wee. Don't we talk about this on the program all the time? Think we got that question coming up. They uneducated. But when I left my home, when I walked away from my family's sheltering arm and every last person on earth who loved me, it was white ladies who stretched out their hands. I'm going to stop right there. Fiction. Fiction. Honest Jay, you should be all ready now.
But by the way, that is a quote. That is a quote from Harriet Tubman, who said that, and that's why I represented it as I did.
Okay. Hello.
Yes, sir. Proceed, Honest Jay. We got you.
Hi. Thank you. Greetings to everyone online today. My question to the author is this: do you feel an entitlement, or that you owe your African American audience explanations as to your credibility or validation regarding fiction? Or do you more or less take the attitude that fiction is an open genre, historical fiction is an open genre, and as an author and a historian, you have license to write as you see fit with whom you see fit? That much is known, but do you feel a heavy sense of burden to validate or explain your position to be able to do so? And if so, do you feel a little bit of a resentment that you probably feel that more so than other people you've done works of historical fiction on who were not of color? Does the dynamic of maybe feeling like there's this passive aggression and this need to validate your credibility and your intentions as far as your artistic works are concerned breed a bit of discomfort or resentment inside of you?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't really, genuinely doesn't. You know, I think it's you know, obviously it can be awkward, right? It is right now. It has been for the last 2 hours. But I think that your questions are really valid. And, you know, obviously to me, this is a conversation that is important to have. And there's some people who would say, and you know, you might be one of them, if, you know, a white person has no place writing about a black person. And maybe fiction is just more that way. I mean, I thought a lot about this, of course, and I thought, well, gosh, I'm a white historian. If I didn't write about President Obama because he's black and I'm white, that would be, to me, very racist, right? So that's in my nonfiction, though, of course, and that's, you know, maybe that's the difference that we all feel, like, you know, fiction feels a little closer to home or something. But no, I don't resent it. I really don't.
Okay. Yeah, I'm more or less speaking, not actually from someone who would feel that you wouldn't have a place writing in that, but if I was in your position, I probably would be more on the other end of the spectrum. As far as, you know, I have the creative license to write, you know, historical fiction or fiction of any sort without having to justify my intentions or justify my credibility or, you know, the pureness of my work or whatever the case may be. So I'm more or less kind of on the other side of that, more so than trying to say you shouldn't mm-hmm. have a place, more so trying to, I'm more so emphasized with the standpoint that you do have a right to create and be artistic without having to validate what your intentions are, or, you know, whether
pardon
or not
honest,
you're
Jay, do you have other questions? We're trying to get through the speechifying and get to the questions so we can make sure we get everybody in.
Oh, sure. Well, that was my question. She answered it, and thank you.
Much obliged, good
Thank
sir.
You.
Thank you for calling in. Let's see, caller 81. I think a caller in Michigan. Is that our mom in Michigan? Did you have a question, ma'am?
Hi, can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, Gus, and to the callers and listeners, and thanks for taking my call. I dialed in late, and so I'm not sure. Did you agree to the guest? Did you agree with Gus's definition of racism, white supremacy, at the beginning of the program?
I think so, yes.
Okay, and so my question to you is...
She did not, and we talked about that. In my view, that's another act of white supremacy racism. All you got to do is be consistent. No, I didn't agree with this definition. Continue. She did not agree with my definition.
I don't want to argue about that. What I said, I'd have to go back and look at the tape to be exactly certain of what I said, but I don't think that everybody is trying to impose a system of white racism, but I do think that there is a system of white supremacy. So that's what I meant by to say I agreed with that. So to me, I am agreeing with it in principle.
Well, based off of your definition of or how you define or experience interacting with individuals, and you're a doctor, and you've wrote this piece, you're speaking about it, who do you think is most confused about racism, white supremacy, meaning the system, how it works, in your experience, based off of the audiences that you speak with, the people you interact with, white people or non-white people? Who do you feel is most confused about the system, what it is, how it works, and why do you feel that way?
I'm going to say this is not something I go around and ask people about, so it would be hard for me to say, who is confused and who's not. It's not what I do. I teach American history, and I'm usually in the past rather than talking about what we're doing today. However, if I'm speaking off the cuff, I think it's white people who are most, in denial about it. That's my experience, but I could be wrong. I don't go out and sample people, but, I do think that there is a underappreciation of racism, by whites, very much so. I mean, that's why I wrote the book.
I'm thinking you said denial, and I didn't use the term denial. I'm just really saying confused. Even if we go back in history, based off of the experiences of slaves and the people who practice racism versus the people who are victims of racism, back then and even today, like, who do you feel would be most confused about the system and what it is, how it works, just in your experience and just your observation?
Well,
I'm not in denial. I really just don't understand what it is and how it works.
Confused. I guess I'm trying to pin that word down for myself to understand better what you mean, because I want to make sure I hear you. In terms of understanding how it works, I think that the people who suffer the consequences of almost anything are more profoundly aware, of exactly how a system works and how a system, can be oppressive. And the people who are perpetuating it are, I don't know if they're less conscious of it, but I think it's easier for them to just take the benefits and not question how they're getting them. So, and if that's confusion, that's as close as I get.
Okay. Would you say you're confused about the system? I'm just curious, just you as an individual.
Understand
how it works?
Let's put it this way. I think that I have a reasonable understanding, but I don't think that my experience is as full as the experience of somebody who's experienced racism firsthand. How could it be? And that's a reason to try to understand more, to try to understand other people's perspective.
Okay. And thanks for answering the question. And so my next question is, who is your intended audience for your book, just in general?
Oh, just, anybody and everybody. I was saying earlier in the show, I know you tuned in a little bit later, that, it's carried in Costco and Target, and, I'd like to have white readers and black readers and Asian readers and Hispanic readers and foreign readers, you know, there's a wonderful woman, by the way, if you're interested in the book, who I think is an African-American actress. I don't know because I've never been able to track her down. Her name is Heidi Franklin. She reads the book and just does the most beautiful interpretation of it. I mean, acts out all the roles, men and women and northerners and southerners and, you know, children and et cetera, and does a really, really beautiful job. So if I was listening to her voice, you know, I'd follow her anywhere. And I'm hoping other readers will feel the same, other listeners, I should say.
Okay, thanks for taking my call.
Much obliged, ma'am. Let's see.
Now, I know we're coming up to the end of our time because we said till 7 o'clock my time and we're about there. Are there any other last questions that you have, Gus? I really want to make sure I hear them all.
Well, I did get him. Can we get him Bondisi? Because we didn't hear from him at all. Can he? Did you have
Of course.
Awesome. Imhan DC, did you have a question, what have you? You should be with us, sir.
Yes, sir. Can I be heard?
Yes, we hear you.
My question, have you heard any of the broadcasts from this particular show?
No, I've never listened to it before.
What's your definition of white supremacy?
Well, I think white supremacy is, you know, a long and persistent, you know, system of privilege, which, you know, at times has had an extremely violent element to it as well. So I think that that's it's sort of, you know, supremacy meaning control over and, you know, higher than, subordinate, you know, creating a system of subordination, so based on color.
Did that answer your question, Imhan DC?
I heard her. Yes, you gave her definition, and so I was asking, can black people be white supremacists? I'm trying to understand the definition, her definition.
I don't think black people could be white supremacists. You know, I don't see why. I mean, that you know, the system of white supremacy would exclude them. But, you know, that's my understanding of it.
Okay. You're saying that your definition of white supremacy is that, I think you're saying there's a group of people who have control over another group of people or privileges. Which group of people has, which group of people are the white supremacists?
Well, of course, there are organized white supremacists, and these are people who actually advocate it. You know, who, you know, advocate that, you know, whites are better than blacks, or them better than Asians, better than Hispanics. So, and that's a, you know, just an awful, awful tradition in American life. You know, and it's not just American, of course.
Do white people? Is it white people? Is white people? Is it white people that practice white supremacy?
You know, not all white people think that way. That's just, they don't.
Okay, I'm sorry. But your definition, I'm trying to go back to the definition. You didn't agree with Gus's definition. And then I'm asking you for the definition. You're telling me a group of people have power over another group of people, and there's privileges. I asked, well, is it black people that are the white supremacists? You said no.
No.
And then I asked,
no,
is
no.
it white people who are the white supremacists? And then you're still, like, you're, I don't know. Is it white people who are white supremacists?
Yes, of course. Not, I don't
so
believe all white. I don't
those,
believe all white people are, but I do think that white people are the ones who are the white supremacists.
What are the actions that makes a white? What are the actions that white people do that makes them a white supremacist?
Well, for example, white supremacist groups. And, you know, take the most obvious example, the KKK, you know, that perpetrated violent terrorism, you know, throughout American history. fortunately, that group has declined, but there were times when it comes back with, you know, roaring back with full force. So I, you know, I think in those circumstances, they're the best example of white supremacists. I think white supremacists to me is a little different from white supremacy.
Sorry. I don't mean to keep interrupting, but I know that our time is limited. What is your action that white people do that makes them white supremacists?
Well, I think anyone who's a white supremacist tries to disenfranchise black people, tries to, for example, gerrymandering to diminish the power of the black vote, or who says racist things, who indulges in, you know, gross stereotypes, which are utterly untrue, but, you know, tending to paint an ugly picture. That would be an example of something a white supremacist would do. The things we've all seen, basically, trying to undermine black people that in whatever way they can, and to keep, you know, white people in control. That's what white supremacy is all about.
Does that also include non-white people? You're talking about actions against black people. What about other non-white people?
I think it applies. You know, I think that there have been some historical periods where that's more true than it is now. But, certainly we saw the Oriental Oriental Exclusion Acts of the 1880s are an example of that, or the 1920s. And some of those laws did get reversed, but, you know, they were certainly examples, really good examples of white supremacy.
Last one.
Sorry.
No apologies.
Last one. Okay. Can there be white supremacy if there are no white people?
I don't see how.
Thank you.
Right on. You asked if I had any other questions. I have two questions. B said she had one final question as well, so that should be our last three, and we can call that a broadcast. B, did you want to get in your one final question? B in Toronto. I think she's still hanging out with us.
Yes. Thank you so much, Gus. I do apologize. When you were mentioning, I couldn't hear because it kind of tapped out on the phone, but thank you so much. So here's the question. So Ms. Cobbs, you mentioned earlier in the program a description of white slaveholders, that they're white identified. They didn't see Harriet Tubman as human. They distanced themselves in seeing her as human, and you classified them as sociopaths. So I was just comparing it to, well, say you. You've classified yourself as white identified. You've created a story of fiction overriding Ms. Tubman's human experience and the reality of the slave experience placed upon her by white supremacists, slaveholders in this case. To her experience, you've explained that would have been done through storytelling, which is still a little unusual to me. So, Ms. Cobbs, since you seem to have a lot in common, would you regard yourself as a sociopath, as you've designated the white slaveholders as sociopaths?
No.
Okay, thank you. I leave the line.
Much obliged, B in Toronto. So my two questions. One, I said I didn't even have it in my notes. If folks recall, it's in the archives. We talked about it was 2016. They were talking about putting Harriet Tubman on the $20 bill. And I think, that was about my response. If we're still going to have a system of white supremacy, what problem would that solve? If there is a system of white supremacy, you have a different definition. But if that system still exists, 2020, placing Harriet Tubman on a $20 bill or $100 bill, any piece of currency, what problem would that solve?
Well, I mean, Gus, to me, these things are not, it's not an absolute. As a historian, I see I see. I don't think the system of white supremacy today is the same that it was 150 years ago when people were legally enslaved. You know, when, as you said, and this is such a heartbreaking thing, when people weren't even allowed to form legal families. I mean, those were just, you know, things that are just so horrific that, to me, whatever we can do to make our world better, and it's incremental and it's never as fast as we want, is a good thing. So to acknowledge Harriet Tubman's heroism is, to me, very valuable, and putting her on the $20 bill would be one small way of doing that. Symbolic, but important. I know you like metaphors, so you talked a lot about metaphors, and that's a metaphor.
I am very suspicious when white people, when you ask for concrete, specific ways that we can solve problems in the system of white supremacy, racism, and you are given metaphors and symbolism, oh man, I tend to think that the person supplying the gifts or metaphors, synonyms, if that's what they're giving you, lots more suspicion. Final question. I mentioned the book before. It's in my top 10, deserves mention again. Delectable Negro, Vincent Woodard, Homoeroticism and Human Consumption in U.S. Slave Culture. There were tidbits of it right here when they used the teacher on one of the black slaves. Reminded me very much of the Delectable Negro, figuring out different ways of punishing black bodies, consuming black bodies, sometimes sexualized, sometimes not. We've had so many. We had Amy Wood on the program, Lynching as Spectacle, and she talked about there would be crowds who would come out to watch, spectate, enjoy a black person, or sometimes a group of black people being tortured and killed, terrorized. We talked about even some of this same spectacle. 2016, 52% of white women voters went with our current president. But we talked about 2016. What stood out for the entire year before all of the, you know, so-called sexism and misogyny was the violence at his campaign rallies, and particularly violence directed at black people. That was the big thing that was being talked about a lot, particularly at the beginning of the year. He didn't even have the Republican Party convention sewn up at the time, and we talked about that seems like another form of white people consuming violence against black people. It's just what was happening at his rallies. That was along the time when we were saying, oh, yeah, I think Trump's going to win. And, yeah, President Donald J. now. We talked about this in so many different forms, even with literature, how punishment of black people, enslavement of black people, that can end up sometimes being another form of this white consumption of black suffering. Throughout the system of racism, white supremacy. And this is a whole genre, plantation fiction. We had Valerie Martin on before. She's a white female author who writes fictional stories about the plantation and tries to show different elements of brutality. There's a lot of literature in this genre dealing with all types. Do you think even your work, The Tubman Command, do you think that that could be another form? Because, I mean, those lynching photographs, this is a huge component of white supremacy racism in terms of white people circulating images, media of different types, consuming black suffering. Do you think Tubman Command could be another component in this plantation literature in consuming black suffering, black death, black enslavement?
No, I don't think so.
Why not?
You know, I think it's when you take things from the historical record, you know, for example, we wouldn't want to, or at least I wouldn't want to never talk about lynching, because to know that some people would, you know, get a kick out of someone else's suffering, right? So the solution to that is not to cease talking about suffering. You know, I think that our understanding of how others have suffered is actually important. Otherwise, we are simply describing the past in ways that are so bland that people don't get it. In the case of the thing you mentioned there, I was trying to depict something that was recorded about the Sea Island plantations, where a sergeant, I think it was, in the U.S. Colored Troops came to Colonel Thomas Wentworth Higginson, who was a white officer, and said, I want to show you something. I want to take you here and show you something. And he took him to a this is a place where this man himself had been enslaved, and he said, I want to show you this jail where we were kept, you know, when our slave master wanted to punish us. And he showed him, and it was a kind of contraption. Of course, it wasn't described fully enough for me to know exactly how it worked, but I wanted to put that in there so that, you know, the readers would understand, regardless of the race of the reader, you know, that this was the sort of thing that, you know, that was real, that occurred. So I don't think I did it in a way that encourages people to, you know, get a kick out of it, if that's what you're suggesting. I don't think that's true. It certainly wasn't my intent, and I don't think it's the effect either. But, you know, you might disagree.
I don't know, but I do know that that is very prevalent. I mean, I would just, you as a historian, you know the massive prevalence of circulating images of dead black bodies and black suffering. That was not a one-off. That, not like the white abolitionist, the alleged white person who was against racism, white circulation of those images, staple in the system of white supremacy racism. It's hard to even put a count on the amount of those types of images and how much that was done, in addition to the actual spectating at these events and enjoying. Isabel Wilkerson, author of Warmth of Other Suns, she talks about how that is carrying on right now in making memes and circulating social images of different corpses of different black bodies and that sort of thing. If that behavior continues, I certainly think literature could be one way. I think that might even be a part of what was submitted in Delectable Negro. I didn't necessarily think of it when you were describing the torture chamber, but the sexual intercourse scenes, oh yeah, definitely thought of it there. There are a few other times, several other times throughout the book where I thought, oh yeah, I could see how racists who enjoy plantation literature, I could see how they would enjoy a book like this. I could be in error. Tubman.
Yeah, well, I'm all I can say is I hope you are, but I really appreciate you bringing me onto the show, and thank you for your time and for letting me talk with your guests.
Much obliged, Dr. Elizabeth Cobbs. We'll check out the documentary Cyberwork and the American Dream as well, streaming on PBS. Enjoy the rest of your evening. We'll, I guess, be mindful of your future works. Thanks, Dr. Cobbs.
Thank you, Gus. Bye-bye.
Evening. Context of white supremacy. White girls do it better. That is the hashtag I used with the program. Easy. I think I did say at the beginning of the program, like, no pussyfooting. Like, we can be, you know, direct about things that have to be discussed. If you don't agree with something, no problem. We spent all that time talking about the definition of white supremacy racism at the beginning of the program to then come back after she said no, she didn't agree, and specifically about, I don't think white people sit around and think consciously, yes, we're maintaining, what am I doing, what can we do to maintain a system of domination over black people, but there is, you know, white people are in charge, but just your definition, I don't agree with that part, to then come back and say, yes, I did agree. Like, there were so many components that stood out. I think having a white person writing a fictional work, even if it was nonfiction, but especially having a white person writing a fictional work where this is presented, she said, Harriet Tubman actually said this. The version of the book that I have, I don't know what all the copies look like. She does have little quotes, historical references at different points in the book, but I mean, it is a work of fiction, so it's not like footnotes and what have you. As at least in my version, maybe they are, but I mean, it's fiction, so I don't think they're footnotes in any version of the book. So you would kind of be reading and having to pick out which portions are made up, which portions are accurate. You don't know. You kind of go back and fact check. So even just a portion of this right here, Harriet spoke across the ward, causing heads to turn. Plenty of folks, she said, ain't no more slaves in the North except one Southerners bring in. None in Canada neither, and the folks in England across the ocean, they gave it up too. The British lion swept away them slavers 30 years ago, freed everybody around the world. America just catching up. That's not even true in 2020. I'm just getting, you know, that away. It'll be easy when January 1 gets here. It'll be familiar. 2020. That's not even true 2020, that all the black people around the world. I wouldn't care if she said it verbatim to the apostrophe. like I said, this is fiction, so I mean, you'd have to dig in. But I mean, even if that's true, there are too many examples. What's the question that was asked tonight? Who's more confused about racism? It's easy to find confused victims. Finishing Paul Robeson right now. Jackie Robinson went and talked all bad about him, called him all those names, and then regretted it. Easy to find confused victims. They got Dr. Martin Luther King. We read that in Harriet Washington, Medical Apartheid. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., in addition to a number of other black people, supported Margaret Sanger and helped her with her racist eugenic agenda in the 20th century. Documented. Victim of racism. Confused. I am still confused. That's lots of us. Happens all the time, right now, 2020. So it's easy to find a black person who was confused and made a speech or a video or what have you. And you got to say, white people are legendary at doing this, being able, and particularly quoting dead black people. I've talked about this for almost the entire time that we've been on the air. And then to continue, white, and this is all Harriet Tubman, and she said that this is from a speech that she made, allegedly. White folks is just folks, she said. Some of the Bukra whites are sinful. And they now reaping the wages of sin. They bloodied and bowed, and their end ain't yet in sight. Many is ignorant, they uneducated. But when I left my home, when I walked away from my family's sheltering arm, and every last person on earth who loved me, it was white ladies who stretched out their hands. I saw them in a dream, and I saw them again when I crossed that holy line into Pennsylvania. Glory, hallelujah! And they break out. This is a church scene. To have a white person writing a scene like that, in a work of fiction where I have to parse out this part is true, this part isn't true, maybe it's all true, I don't see how that helps us solve any problems or even get an accurate understanding of what it means to be white in a system of racism. All of that was standing. When she mentioned the CIA the second time, that stood out. That was when I asked the question about the CIA. When she mentioned the second, because it was early, I think that was within the first 20 minutes of the broadcast, and she mentioned CIA again. I was not excited about Elizabeth Cobbs. Like, there are white people that I've been like, oh yeah, I am really looking forward to talking to this white person, talking about their work or whatever, like, you know, for whatever reason. She was not one. I am not going to be excited about a fictional account. Like, I don't even read fiction. This is historical fiction written by a white woman. Like, are you serious? Anyway, when she said CIA, second time, like, whoa, this is not just some, you know, one of these little low-power white people who writes nonsense about racism or does some fiction. She is a New York Times bestselling author. She has a PBS documentary. She said, when she said CIA the second time, and I asked, like, do you have some sort of affiliation? Have you worked with the CIA? And she said, no, that might not be true. You can work for the CIA and lie about it, right? But she said, I worked with the government. I even forgot I would have to go back and listen, because she said she worked with them for 6 years, and part of it involved going through CIA records. Now, how many white people, that's on their resume? That's a part of what I did, review CIA records for transparency. That was about the point right there where I said, wow, I have underestimated or not. At least that's why I said you can't be thinking. I wasn't thinking she was a no power, low level white person, but I just was not like, oh, man, I'm super excited. Dr. Cobbs is coming on the program. We're going to talk about Tubman Command and all that. That was not my thought process. It was not, wow, this is a really powerful white woman. I don't think you just get your book in like Costco, because she said that a few times. She said, excuse me, Tubman Command is in Costco. It's in Walmart. This is intended to be a bestseller. Like, this apparently has major backing. I don't think you just get your book in Costco and Walmart. Like, those the books that are in those stores typically are very slim selection. Like, they don't, it's not Amazon, it's not Borders or Barnes and Nobles or some of the other major chains where you can go and they have a wide select. That's not Walmart and Costco. Like, I would, this is a very powerful white woman. And then looking at her responses, in addition to her tenure that she holds at Stanford, at two different universities, Stanford and Texas A&M, like, wow, I just marveled at listening and even just paying attention to the responses about women. That was something that I noticed. She had a pattern of doing that, talking about Harriet Tubman as a woman. She wouldn't reference her as a black, even black woman. It would just be woman. And I said consistently, that word generally, when woman is used, they're talking about white women. They're not talking about black females. That's not what's happening. I was pretty certain that the patriarchy component was going to come up, that male-dominated society, even though she couldn't give any reasons or evidence as to how I dominate as a male in this society. And this is, as I said, a powerful white woman. How many folks think they can just get a documentary on PBS streaming, producing a documentary for PBS, no less? A job reviewing government CIA records for 6 years. This is not Edward Snowden, Howard high school dropout. Not at all. I think at least a few folks have listened to the idea. Wait a minute. Maybe it's not a system of patriarchy. Maybe these white women are a little more powerful in the system after all. Dr. Cobbs is a powerful white woman. Wow. I guess the only other thing I will get in, the dishonesty where, like I said about the definition, white women allegedly making less than black males. That's absurd. Dr. Curry talked about that. U.S. Department of Labor statistics showed that to be false. I feel like there was another pretty major component. I'm sure I will remember. Oh, the racism thing. I've said consistently, black people have been killed just for talking about racism. What you say is extremely important as a part of codification. I never just recklessly say, oh yeah, this racist white woman here, this no good racist. I never talk like that, and particularly not publicly. Like, that is totally incorrect. I do not. In fact, I actively discourage victims of racism from calling white people racist. If I'm going to call any white person racist, the word that will be in front of it is admitted racist. That I am not just calling this person that. This person admitted to being a racist, and I will generally have the date, time, if it was on this broadcast, the program, all of that information. You do not want to be reckless about that. Racist can cause problems for you for just being reckless and accusing, and at minimum you can't prove it. But that's just a part of my codification. I do not just carelessly accuse or label anyone classified as white as racist. And I just don't. This is a powerful white woman, best-selling author, who has done a lot of interviews. I'm pretty certain she knew what I said, and I'll stop there. I wish I had, been correct with the Pipkin character, making sure he's black. Strive for accuracy. Say that all the time. We have enough deception as is. We don't want to contribute to that with having unnecessary errors. So strive for accuracy. We'll do better on that. But like I said, I was not like super enthused. I didn't watch. I'm not swept up in that. I was not watching the Harriet Tubman biopic. I have no plan to see that. So I was not. Oh yeah, I am overjoyed. We can talk to this best-selling white fiction author about her novel on Harriet Tubman. But make no mistake, Dr. Cobbs is a very powerful white woman, and I am going to watch the documentary film. The folks who dialed in, did y'all have any observations, thoughts that you wanted to share?
Yes, yes, sir. Mr. Thomas shared with me some pre-information on this evening's guest. And as I was looking at both reports, she used the word freedom a lot. And also, she kept referring, as you mentioned, she kept referring to Miss Tubman only with the description of woman. She kept using that term. And that was my motivation to ask her directly, on what does she mean with the word freedom, which is, I mean, when I really formally got myself personally involved with having a better understanding of the global system of racist white supremacy, first of all, I didn't even know how to articulate what I just said a few seconds ago. It was this term freedom that just kept coming up. and something in my mind, it didn't make sense to me of freedom, you know, which I believe, I don't know what it is English-wise. It's not an adjective, is it, Gus?
best to ask the person who used it, but I believe that is most often used as a noun. Person,
right,
place,
right.
Or thing.
Okay, there you go, because I did not do well in English. But yes, as I it was used even by the people that was around me, is word freedom, and somehow I went along with it, but it didn't really make me comfortable that I was saying and thinking the right things until I met Mr. Fuller, who really put things, you know, helped me put things more in order. That's primarily what I would give him credit for personally. So with her using that term as a white person, especially under the global system of racism, white supremacy. And as you mentioned, she is a very, if Ms. Tubman was alive today, I would dare say that she would really have a time with her as far as researching her as a spy, this white female, by the name of Cobb. I believe that's her last name. She would really have a time with her, you know, as far as that concerned, because she is a very refined white female, which we have really did research on and had guests of a lot of white people, and a lot of white people were white females, white women, and she certainly is up there with the more refined understanding in that light. And you know, sometimes by asking a white person something basic would give some relevance to where their truth mindset is. And I think I got that when I asked her the definition of the word under the global system of racist white supremacy. And I think she got it as an idea that it really doesn't make any sense to talk about something called freedom, even for a white person. You know, does that white person have freedom to mistreat people based on color? You know, that could be a question. You know, but and last but not least, with the idea of, and I wasn't going to go further because it would only be something useless of the exchange of words. I just asked the question of, can you be a woman and be subject to the system of racist white supremacy at the same time? And she gave the answer that I expected for her to give. But I think she is refined enough to understand the truth of the matter is that Ms. Tubman, under the global system of racist white supremacy, is not not a quote unquote doesn't qualify as a woman. Along with her as a white female under the system of racism, white supremacy. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter. I think that's Tapello. Yes, sir.
Heard?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. She keeps using the word Gullah for her description of the language that she claimed. I believe that she was claiming that our great heroine was speaking. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, to my study, and this is where I try to focus in this area, so that we can have accuracy of who we're talking about and why I bring up the Racial Integrity Act, which we know is what racism and what it did in an active terrorist behavior
declassify, it should say reclassify a people and make them into black people. Okay? Because black people are created. And we know they're created, and how they're done, because we talk to people who wrote the books, the lady from South Africa, I'm sorry, from Australia, who wrote the book Picket Fence. We've read the book by Madiba's book, and we've heard how he told how the one of the chiefs, how they treated him, and they burned his land and killed his crops and stuff like that, and took all his things. You see, this is how they make black people. So when I ask her, what is a black person? And you're supposed to be a historian. And the first thing you come up with is someplace in Africa or any place. That is a deliberate lie. Because they, like she just said, everything is based on the color. Racism is based on the mistreatment by color. So to make somebody into a black person, you're making them into a slave by the color of their skin. This is what gives the opposite to white, which gives the white the value. And the value is freedom, the opposite of slave. Freedom and debt free. So they want to push the idea that all people of fair skin to be free and debt free, and they know everything, and it's all honky dory to be these fair skinned people. But if you're dark skinned, you're black, and you're from Africa. You see how they always want to tie dark-skinned people to Africa. And it's not refined. It's what eugenics is. So she's using eugenic science. She's not really a real historian. She's a propaganda machine. So she's a fraud. If she's calling herself a historian, she's a fraud. And she's got these documents from two schools, like you said, and she's got a voice for a black woman in a picture in a story where she's gonna obviously have to put it in a fictional platform, but then she's gonna also say, hey, well, there's some things that are true about it, and this is what our children have to deal with. When they're going to school, they have to try to decipher from people like this. A Gullah is not an African. It is a Native American. Gullah Geechee. My grandmother's Gullah Geechee. So if the heroine is speaking Gullah, then she's not an African. And that might explain why she knew her way around, being the first peoples of the land. It's in the blood. But hey, this is what we have to deal with. We have to deal with our identity. We have to fight against this. We have to uphill battle. We have to decipher. And I'm glad we have programs like this so we can listen to these people, listen to their lives, and then listen to other of those of us that are lesser confused, and we're still learning, and we can share ideas. You know, to lie about simple stuff shows how really dedicated to the system of racism and white supremacy that she is. We don't want to say that she's a racist, but I say if she practices it, if she practices racism, she therefore should not be suspected as a racist no more if she practices it.
30 seconds.
But we have to prove it though.
I don't know about that. But I'm just going to go with the belief if she practices it, then therefore she is. She is what she is. Thank you for that. I'll mute my line.
May I be heard?
Much obliged to Bello. Be in Toronto. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. I just had two quick comments that I just wanted to add. I'm surprised. Well, you know what? She's a product of affirmative action, and the one of the groups that benefit the most, which are white women, with a special kind of something. So she says that she's a historical professor. However, she used a quote, or she created a quote for Harriet, comparing United States' ability to end slavery to that of Canada. Now, just to give it in historical context, I understand with American slavery, even though it really never ended, the Emancipation of Proclamation was in 1865. Canada wasn't known as Canada that time. Canada was known as British North America. Canada became Canada under its Confederacy in 1867, 2 years after the so-called Proclamation of Emancipation. So that was the first thing. I'm surprised. Well, actually, no, I'm not surprised that she did not get that. But just to give you some insight, also the fact that, Underground Railroad, white people in Canada, or under that time, British North America, were not helpful. They weren't allies. Many had returned victims back to collect a bounty. And we're just as racist here as well, because they also, some owned plantations in the States as well as in Canada. Before Canada even so-called ended their slavery, but I digress. In answer to Thomas in New York, in regards to Harriet Tubman and her involved, like where she would have been, I'm paraphrasing, where she would have been in the suffragette movement. Well, Miss Elizabeth Cobbs, she wrote an opinion article with the Washington Post that ironically has a quote that says, "Democracy dies in darkness." This was published on June 2nd, 2019. The title is, "What Took So Long for Women to Win the Right to Vote? Racism is One Reason." And this is just a snippet of that article where it says, "White women leaders were little better not denouncing congressional racism and instead banishing black women to the back of the suffrage parade." So chances are Miss Harriet Tubman would have been in the back of the suffrage parade based on Miss Cobbs' article. And again, it's not surprising. She practiced deception throughout this program, so it's not surprising she failed to mention this in her answer to you. Thank you, and I leave the line.
Much obliged to be in Toronto. Thank you all for asking quality questions. I was very pleased with listeners' questions today. Affirmative action. Always love it. Remind them, Dr. Cobbs, that right there should be the poster child metaphor for affirmative action. I know we didn't miss everybody, so if other folks have comments, speak up. Number one, does anybody think that she may now or ever have been employed for the CIA?
Hell yeah. Can I be heard?
Got a couple. I just wanted to get the answer real quick, and then you'll be our next speaker, Thomas, in New York.
Very possible.
A few.
Yes.
A few. This is just a quickie, so you get, so we can get better with time. You get a maximum of 10 seconds so we can get to Thomas in New York. Any thoughts on her saying Harriet Tubman is like Spiderman, Queen Latifah, and Mother Teresa rolled in one? Max 10
Propaganda.
Seconds. Propaganda. Okay.
The Queen Latifah part, I thought
like Queen Latifah is an entertainer, and I think I've heard like, I think she's been referenced as practicing anti-sexuality. It might just be me, you know, maybe being anti-black, but those are the two thoughts that came to mind about Queen Latifah.
Misappropriating dead niggers.
She was either imagination for Spiderman, entertainer and humorist for Queen Latifah, and for Mother Teresa, well, Mother Teresa was racist. So Harriet Tubman, I guess, was racist too. She was really trying to loop her personality onto Harriet.
I agree with that. Her whole avenue is to speak, put her white ideology, her, what is that word I'm looking for? Her
10 seconds.
Not her behavior, but her character, into a black person. You know.
Got it. All righty, Thomas in New York. Thank you. Was there somebody else? Do you need to get your 10 for the metaphor?
Just that she is an absolute liar, and that Harriet Tubman is nothing like those people, and that she mentioned a whole lot of different people, like a whole bunch of different races can relate to those people. So perhaps a whole bunch of different races will read her book. Maybe.
Metaphors. All righty, Thomas in New York. We'll nab other folks if we missed him as well.
Oh, great. Thank you, Gus, man. Great show, Gus. Very good. Love when you have white guests, and I love when they're practicing white refinement. Thank to the sister for the article. I studied the waves of feminism. It's four waves. And I would advise other black people to study this. This is how white people are positioning the feminist movement and the four waves, starting with the suffrage movement. So I was very familiar, and like, it's impossible for a black woman to be a part of the suffrage movement. Even though a lot of the white women who were a part of the suffrage movement were a part of it because they were abolitionists with the intent to free the slaves so that way they can get rights over those slaves because they had no rights. So very interested in to the brother. My research also places the Gullah people as non-African Americans, you know, from here. She did show the power of having a code, as whites all have. All of the whites Gus has had on the show over the years that we work with, that we encounter on a daily basis, all seem to follow the same pattern. That's their code. And she stayed on code, as you know, as expected. And the code of racist refinement is called whiteness studies. That's why I asked her that question. It's the major component of critical race theory, white critical race theory. As for her doing being part of the CIA. You know, doing programs on PBS about a jobless America, you said, Gus, or when people are replaced by automation and machines and there are no jobs, things of that nature. And she said she was trying to help people save their jobs and keep their jobs in the face of automation. That's impossible, you know. It's no job's going to be safe. So the global system of white supremacy, a huge component of it is a lot of CIA assets. They belong to these groups called NGOs or non-governmental agencies, which set up shop in other countries. And she fits the criteria of someone that would be able to infiltrate, that they could use, have go to another country. She's a professor, so her credentials are right. She's a historian. She could go around giving speeches, getting all kinds of information for them. She fits the criteria of the type of person that they use. They also use a lot of actors and things like that to do a lot of their bidding. But just the last thing, the power of, and I was glad she pointed that way. I'm going to go back and listen, because she said pretty much all history can't be, unless we can hear it or see it, you know, it's not, you know, we can't prove it. So a huge percentage, she didn't say a huge percentage, but she alluded to the fact that there's a huge percentage of history that's just fabricated. It's just fiction. The person writing it decided, okay, since this happened, and that's the two facts, I could write this fictional part here that will tie those two facts together, because in his or her mind, that's what happened. Then that becomes what they put in our textbooks and teach us, and in one or two generations, that's the truth. And I see them totally rewriting Harriet Tubman's history. Putting her on the bill is a bad thing. It's going to be terrible. Black people killing each other for Tubman's. And then you're going to have her as the face of feminism and the suffrage movement when she was a slave in the 1840s when a lot of that stuff happened. There's a case with, I forget the name, something of slave, where the black woman is raped by the white slave master, goes to the court, she kills him, in the course of the rape, and they hang her, even though she was being raped. The court ruling was a black woman can't resist any, she has no rights. So this is the person that Harriet Tubman was in that time period at the beginning of that movement when she's trying to free slaves. I just don't agree with a lot of what she said. So, Gus, I'll mute my line. Thank you.
Much obliged, Thomas in New York. I do encourage folks to not use the term fair when describing individuals classified as white, their complexion, because they use that word for justice and beauty. And white, I just say pale, or you can pick a different descriptor, but it's definitely not fair. Suggest that people who have quote unquote fair skin are the only ones who deserve fairness, justice. So I definitely discourage that. Do we have anybody else who had a comment they wanted to get in?
Can I be heard?
Imhan DC?
Yes, sir. I'm going to speak fast. The question that I wanted to ask but was not going to ask is, what color are Native Americans? What color were the Native Americans? What color is she? And that she would give a whole bunch of different, I don't know what answers. She probably would say she's white, but then I would say, I wouldn't say, but I would, white people are pink. They're not like the color white. And then the Native Americans, they would probably, white people would probably say, oh, the Native Americans were black, were brown. Black people, what color are black people? White people would say, black people are brown. And then I wanted to say, as far as, let me look at my notes, because I had looked at her C-SPAN. Okay, she called Harriet Tubman a patriot. So at another time, I would have asked her, what is a patriot? She called Harriet Tubman a drag, as in a drag queen. She said that America did certain actions, like America was racist or was white supremacist. She said something, America did the actions against black people instead of white people did the actions against black people. She said that only a woman could do what Harriet did. What does that mean? She called Harriet a criminal several times. She said that Harriet inherited a gene that we did not. This is in her her talk on C-SPAN. She said that Harriet inherited a gene that we did not, and that's the reason why Harriet was so courageous, or whatever. But then I saw the audience, and the whole audience was black. So the gene that she inherited, that the white audience, excuse me, I saw the audience, the entire audience was white, was pink, was albino. So the gene that Harriet would have inherited that the white audience didn't inherit would probably be like a black gene or something. And then, let's see, what was that last thing? Oh, she mocked Harriet. She mimicked Harriet falling out of consciousness or going out of consciousness. And then when she mocked it, so she did the mimic and she leaned over, showing that this is how she would have fallen out of consciousness. But she did a real dramatic, like if she had leaned over any further, she might have fallen, this speaker that just spoke. And after she got done mocking and mimicking Harriet, she stood back up and she started laughing. And then she said she did that for fun, as the speaker mimicked Harriet for fun, her falling out of consciousness for fun. Thank you.
That is an important part in the video. I posted the video he's talking about. I posted it on Facebook, I think, maybe somewhere else. Definitely Facebook, I posted it. I think, well, I'll double check, but I did just want to make sure I got in. I do think that that's pretty significant to have a book like this that widespread, and even the timing, like nothing is a coincidence, like for her to have influence at PBS with the streaming service and then to have her book coming out released near the same time period. That book came out, I think, right at the beginning of the summer, late spring, summer, like May, June-ish. And so it's timed pretty closely to the Tubman biopic. So you get carryover attention. I'm sure people are finding out about this who saw the film and vice versa, just because, you know, she's being talked about more. Like, that is generally, say, not a coincidence, system of racism. Anything else folks want to make sure they get in?
Anytime I hear a white person talk about increments to solving the problem of racism, white supremacy, and or improvements, they go high on my suspect list. That's it.
I just wanted to, I thought, yeah, like what you were saying about her really being like a powerful white person, like, there were moments where I was shocked, like when I read your description on Facebook. I had to look like twice. Like, I was like, there's two universities, like, and then like when she said Costco, she said Costco and Target. I think that's what she said. So I was like, whoa. I mean, that's impressive. And then the State Department and the CIA, but the State Department, even if she just said the State Department alone, that's probably, that's probably the most powerful sort of like foreign interference body in the world. Like, I don't know if I'm saying it correctly, but diplomats, spies, etc. And also, I think that what stood out for me wasn't really her refinement, because there's been a lot of folks just like that, but she stayed perky the whole show. She stayed, it just wasn't that she stayed on code, but she was perky. Usually, like, especially like these white women guests, at some point they get tired on your show, or they might, I mean, she did practice racism, lied multiple times about you, but she, even after she lied and folks caught her lying, she was still giggling and happy. So that stood out for me. Thank you.
I thought that was important as well. U.S. for that, I think that was where she said her area of expertise was U.S. foreign relations at the very beginning. It was not U.S. history. It was not Civil War history. It was U.S. foreign relations.
She gives the impression that she's an expert in history. You see, that's how she'll fool black people. She gives the impression that she's an expert in this stuff, in history of the United States, of the Americas, is what she said. She wrote books on it, remember?
She has a doctorate in history, so, I mean, she does have expertise as a U.S. historian, but just that was, I think she focused specifically in saying U.S. foreign relations at the beginning. I guess before we wrap up, we'll be here tomorrow for the book club. Last session, Paul Robeson, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, and Workplace Racism, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific for Friday. Compensatory call-in Saturday, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. Anything else I wanted to make sure? What did folks make her assessment of white women that they did not vote in their own self-interest in 2016?
Deceptive.
Primary weapon of white.
Yes, she wouldn't. She wouldn't take that argument in front of a lot of white women. She definitely wouldn't. She would have a hard time. Gus, do you have the address of the retreat on the website?
No, All of the updated information will be emailed, but no, none of that is on posted.
Oh, okay, okay, I got you. Okay, okay, because I was going to pay my second portion within the next 48 hours.
Gotcha, gotcha. Yes, that is will be email updates forthcoming. All of the information with the retreat and. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, it'll just be emailed. It won't be posted.
All right.
Any other comments? Anything else folks need to get in before we conclude?
And these are the people that's teaching our kids. That's the messed up part. Yeah. All professors. Did you say she was at the same college as Dr. Terry?
Texas, University of Texas A&M. Yep, that's where she's at. Or one of the institutions.
Wow, have you spoken? Okay, because I was wondering if he's familiar with her and her work, her writing. This book, The Fictional Tale of Harriet Tubman, which in a generation will be the truth. You know, it's, you know, I just wanted to know what his thoughts was on that. She's his colleague.
I have no idea. Like, he is trying, or he has taken a position overseas in establishing a black male studies program. So I'm sure that has taken up a lot of his time and energy, because that's, you know, a major effort to get a whole program, like a university program around black male studies. So yeah, I don't know if he's aware of this work specifically or aware of her in general, some of her other work. But yeah, I would be curious. I don't know if. Yeah, checking out this work of fiction. I don't know. I'm sure he might be curious. He's, you know, at his institution. He might already know of her. It's a lot of I think Texas A&M is a larger institution, so I'm sure he doesn't know every single professor there and that sort of thing. But I would be curious if he has seen it, has a thought or two.
And I wonder how much of her, because she bragged about her other book, which was about these white female soldiers who were mistreated and overlooked when they came home and wasn't treated like they were part of the military, the poor white women. I wonder how much of the books on white people that she makes is all fictional. I'm quite sure that that book is historically accurate when she's talking about, you know, herself. And as far as the white woman wrote, if you haven't noticed, they have not really mentioned that on any media outlet. I remember right after the election, they complained about only getting 88% of the black vote.
Right.
Didn't mention, Hillary Clinton didn't even mention black people in her concession speech. It was, you know, the women before for the glass ceiling and nothing about all the 88% of the black people. That's all I was going to say, guys.
I remember that concession speech well. I was shouting, lock her up, the whole time. But I remember we put 1,000 cracks in that glass ceiling and all that other, yeah, there was no shout out to black people at all in the concession speech. And that was the major takeaway in my view. I remember they talked about it a few times, but I haven't heard it referenced. Like, what is, you know, what are the Democrats going to do to shore up white women? Like, you know, black people were, you know, in lockstep as usual, but, you know, no count white women. What are we going to do to make sure we don't have a repeat where they go for Trump again? I haven't heard that talked about at all. That was, you know, right there, 1A. Went the brilliance of Dr. Welsing, white women riding with Trump. Those were the top two lessons. You can go back, it's well documented in the archives. Major two lessons from 2016, 4 more years. Been saying that for the last 4 years, basically. It's 2020 already. Been saying that for 4 years. 4 more years, have seen nothing that's going to change that. 4 more years. With that, yeah, I don't think she would have said that about white women not knowing their own self-interest in a group of, well, like when at the lecture, I believe in D.C. at C-SPAN, I don't think she would have got up there and said, oh, yeah, that's how patriarchy works. White women didn't vote in their self-interest in 2016. Let that ride and see you. 10 seconds, because we're done. Have 10 seconds.
Yeah, I just went ahead. I always wanted to ask this question to these feminists.
5 seconds.
Who does the queen answer to?
There we go.
The queen of England answers.
Much obliged.
What bell tells the queen?
That is 10 seconds.
What to do?
Thank you, sir.
If I'm not on the thank show, you, somebody obliged, ask that sir. Question.
Much obliged. Thank you, Topello. We will be back in 24 hours for the book club. Reading is more important than watching television. Always nice to get practice questioning whites. The problem. White women, white men, white children. The problem. Thanks, everyone, for participating. Hope it was worthy of your time and energy. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. Stay sober. That comes up in the book, Tubman Command. That even came up there. Stay sober. Preserve the brain computer. In addition to staying sober, if you are going to be in a vehicle, passenger or driver, you are buckled up every time. If you're driving, you're sober, you're buckled up, and you are not on the cell phone, doing all the little things that we can to stay as safe as possible under extraordinary conditions of white terrorism. With that, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people. Victims of white supremacy, we ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, brother.
No problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.